and run.
You deserve that break, so come take it with us inside the entertainment block. Let's stay trending as we rethink afternoon radio.
Baby, when the bright lights are to fade, fire up your light.
So catch the vibe and ride the wave. Every day, 1 to 5 p.m., right here on Nationwide 90 FM, your new revolution in media.
Three, two, one.
Welcome to Nationwide's Entertainment Block, your number one choice in afternoon radio.
You're ready?
Yeah, you know I fully body bad got attack, you know. You represent for the sound of. I'm here to your current, your triple X. When that one that drop, then triple vex. Fully.
Running, running.
When you want to hear the sound of. The sound off, you can't listen it and don't off. The sound off, hear me as I keep it represented to the fullest and I mean. For the sound off, Monday to Friday, 1 to 3, on Nationwide 90 FM, the new revolution in media. Man!
Get them ready, show them what we used to.
Okay, 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 okay. At the sound off, Nationwide 90 FM, 1 to 3 p.m. Live.
Ain't believing us, God did.
What's up, it's Megan Sue, and you're listening to the sound off on Nationwide 90 FM.
Sound off Monday to Friday on Nationwide 90 FM.
This is Beanie Man. Give it to them, Zaga, Zen.
Oh, you mean?
All right.
Nationwide is on your side.
Yo, you hear me? I said, man, I text it up, so you're listening to the sound off one to three every day on Nationwide. You know the job. Love.
The number one power mixer.
Nationwide 90 FM. This is Beanie Man. Give it to them, Zaga. Zen.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is Tuesday. So you are going on. You are going on, people. Let me tell you something.
Tuesday. What happened?
You see, on a Tuesday.
Yes.
I am going to tell you from now.
What?
You see, the views expressed by myself and Karen are not necessarily those of Nationwide 90 FM. I am only hoping and praying that my producers edited what I said. Ask them to edit. I am hoping. Mr. Mina, look through the script read fully yet. Look through the first part. Look through the last part. I'm just hoping that Jeremy felt like she wanted to make me feel extra special today. But don't feel that way. Karen, let me tell you something about Jamaica.
I would like you to.
It is the land of my birth. I don't know where you were born, but I was born in Jamaica.
Okay.
And I love this country very much.
I'm sure you do.
And if I would have a foolish just going out there.
A whole heap.
But me, I'm going to tell you the truth. No, you're no better than yard.
But you know how to, you need to know how to dealt with the foolishness.
And that is it, man.
All right. And okay.
Yes, man. So you are going on, people. Big up the persons who are tuned in right now. The persons who are locked into the Nationwide 90. Big up everybody who are driving at traffic. The people them with their work.
Yep.
The people them with their home. The people them with their bank. The people them with their post office. The people them with their on the road. Yeah. Big up the people them with their behind bars too. All the people them who incarcerated. Members say we don't come out. We want a better life from oh no!
Exactly.
You understand me? I say.
And you know who we must pick up? All of the police in halfway.
That
tree.
Is it.
Did you pass by halfway?
No,
I'm
not going to say that. Can we get a message and say no go around
about 60 of them just stand up. I don't know if graduation just happened. Graduation just happened. Me don't know.
No, man, they're not practical, no, man.
What?
Oh, them my practical God. Now. And they, trust me, you trust see the young police, them just come out.
Them very active.
Them is very righteous.
Them very righteous.
So yes. if you know, say you have any form of
very excited
traffic infringement or anything wrong with your vehicle.
What?
Park it at your yard.
Exactly.
You hear me tell him? Now, ladies and gentlemen, who else want to be the persons on YouTube?
Yes.
Remember this, you know, YouTube people, una we bread and butter. You guys are the pulse that we can feel to know how it is that the people are receive out here.
Mm-hmm.
And please, continue to come in, continue to say good, bad, or indifferent. Remember, say we love it. We just love the interaction from you guys.
Yeah.
Make sure you subscribe. And please, not going to from now, just make sure you like up the thing, no man. Anyways, the persons who have not downloaded the Nationwide app yet, come on, guys. Let's do this, man. It's free. Remember, say all the things in Jamaica are free, no? So when we are giving free things, collect it.
Call it.
Make
now.
Sure you go over the
right
App Store,
now.
Google Play Store, yep. And download it quick and fast before you hear. So them got Congress, because say them are going to block the Nationwide app. Because we don't know.
No, they can't do that, man, because we're Nationwide. We're on your side.
That is it,
so
man.
Let me just explain to you why it is so important for you to like up the live. When you like up the live, it's not just because me and Triple just want to see that you like us. It really helps our algorithm, and then you know with algorithms, it's a series of instructions that, you know what I'm saying, you know all of that. What it does know is to put it in front of more people, so they will now start to subscribe. And we need you to do this, seriously. All right, so we have a rampack show for you today. You know it is what, Troublesome Tuesday?
Yeah, man. So you want me know, people have a jump in and ripped from the headlines that we have a talk of mine. I don't know, at 1:45, my favorite part of the show, what's
of course
on
it would be.
Your lunch menu. The what's WhatsApp numbers are 876-280-6629. And Karen, we always tell them, so they must make the food, right?
Yes, make the food really beautiful.
I like
make
that.
Make sure that we can eat with our eyes as well. And you know what happens? You know what we can't eat with our eyes? The chicken foot.
You know what I'm saying? You got to stop them something. But anyways, big other people I'm over TikTok, though.
Agree.
No. Speak for yourself.
Help the people, help me.
Speak for yourself.
Help the people.
Now, here we are going. We are going to jump right into Ripped from the Headlines right now. Razzie, you ready for my father?
And extra, read all about it.
It's ripped from the headlines.
Jerome, Triple, do you know that you can announce that you want to retire or announce that you have retired and then come back about 2 years later and say, no, I'm not about to want to retire? No.
Jordan, do it 2 times.
Okay, all right, okay. Here we go. So dancehall artist Mr. Lex now has joined that group of people. And, you know, he changed his mind about retiring from dancehall industry as he looked to extend his stay in the music career that has already spanned 30 years. It's 30 years late, Mr. Lex, in this thing. The Gonna Make Some Money singer had announced in 2022 that he would be stepping away from the recording booth for good, but is now singing a different tune. After careful consideration to remain active in the industry and release new music. I just, my friend them convinced me still and all. In my immediate circles. And say, you know what? I no time yet. And me say, all right. I no bother fight it. So he's back in the game. He's back in the ring. And we're looking for some great things from Mr. Lex. Let's say you.
Say you.
Yeah.
All right. Lexus, big up yourself. Mm-hmm. Extremely talented. For the persons who were born in the, who had sense in the 90s. No one say, Lexus did have a wicked piece of running. Allow me to tell, full 100. I'm gonna make some money. You know that I'm with it. Gyal better can cook and them something. He had a wicked piece of running. That's why me tell you, I don't business nobody want to say this. When Lexus talk, when Lexus supposed to eat bounty killer, like poison. A bounty mash up a man career. No?
Really?
Allow me to tell Razzie.
Razzie is true.
A bounty mash up a man good career. No?
How bounty mash up him career? Because
bounty did call use an adjective that is used. To define how you drink a bag juice and mingle it with him name. Allegedly.
Oh.
You understand what I'm saying? So because of those that adjective them did place behind the first part Alexa's name and that, and then there were some insinuations allegedly.
Okay.
And it cramped, it never recover.
Really?
He never recover.
Really?
Plus Futa did start to like run
okay,
into from
go.
Early.
Right, well.
And him and Futa did have like an altercation.
Him into the ring.
Up at Monday, are ready. Allegedly. Mm-hmm. And him did throw a fist to Futa Ibe's cranial part. Allegedly. And then he proceeded to be massacred by Futa Ibe and his followers.
Man.
Allegedly.
Futa Ibe.
Yeah, but I got to tell you the truth. If I never did fit them incidents, Lexus would have been one of the general them, they column them in a musical. Lexus is an extremely talented. No, Lexus, Mr. Lex is an extremely talented individual, you know. May I tell you, you know?
So Clash says, right. Lexus must mash him own a career. That's what Clash Camp said. Mash him own a career. Well, it is what it is. We'll see what's coming and we wish him luck. Here we go. So Skilly Bang's feature on the debut album of the I'm a Piano Sensation, Tyler, is a collaboration with the rap star Gunna titled Jump. Tyler confirmed that the collaborative feature during a tracklist reveal on Sunday night via her social media. The dancehall A-lister, who's also shared the news, is one of only six featured acts on the highly anticipated 14-track project set for Friday, March 22. That's the release date. Skilly Bang's inclusion in the project reaffirms the growing international craving for his sound. Having previously featured on Nicki Minaj's Pink Friday 2, DJ Khaled's God Did, and Wizkid's More Love, Less Ego albums. All right, Skilly Bang, a fly that fly.
That's all right, let me tell you something. What I read about Skilly, him find him sound and stick to him sound. You understand me, I say? Him figure out what the international market is craving and he's sticking to that. So we have to support that. We have to embrace that. You understand? And irrespective of the fact, some people say it is not. You have some people, the naysayers, they say, oh, an authentic dancehall. It is still dancehall-esque. Some people say it's a trap version of dancehall, but it's still dancehall. You understand? And he might pave the way for a younger and a next generation of artists to emerge. The better he does, internationally, it is the better it is for our music and the persons, the talent pool that is here in Jamaica. So big up to Skilly Bang and him entire team.
I totally confer. We confer. We don't always have to agree. We don't always have to agree, you know, guys. Once somebody is doing well on the international stage, support. All right.
That is
so
it, man.
Here's the thing now. Ariana Grande and her husband of 2 years, Dalton Gomez, have officially settled their divorce, according to TMZ TV. Per their agreement of their settlement, Ariana will have to pay a lump sum of a whopping $1,250,000 to Dalton and split the sale of their LA home.
For what?
2 years investment in making of that, and he comes out.
You go, King.
You go.
You go, King.
You go.
That's you go, King.
A two-year investment. We're telling
you. Have to walk away from this toxic woman.
No, King. No. It's not. Which toxic? Why you have to go to yourself? Why? Why? Imagine now this poor lady, this wonderful lady.
She's not poor because she has millions to go pay the man.
You know what I mean by poor.
Okay, go on.
This wonderful, hardworking woman will have to pay this man $1,250,000 and then have to go sell our house and give him half.
Nothing wrong with that.
As we previously reported, Ariana filed the paperwork to end their marriage in September 2023. Yeah, because she knows same toxic. But the couple separated in July of 2023. After they separated, Ariana started dating actor Ethan Slater in July 2023.
When them separate?
In September. They filed the paperwork to end their marriage in September 2023.
And she started dating a man from July.
Separated in July.
And started dating a man in July.
And then she started to date in 2023. And the couple
July 2023.
Appeared.
She started dating.
Yes, so she separate physically 2023. And she started dating 2023. And the couple appears to be still going strong.
I can tell you something.
Yes, man, tell me.
Can I say something?
Please do.
She have that man there for a long time.
Of course.
A long time she have that man there. Hey, let me tell you something.
Of course.
Bossy.
Yes.
You see, when you see a woman, first of all, a woman na come out with a man until it's settled, signed, sealed, and delivered. Simmer, gravy, tick down and everything. Rice, shear out, vegetable done, chill in the fridge, and the marinate does everything good before she come out with a man.
Yeah.
Was it a married woman? She been with a youth from all year and a half or six.
Yeah.
The least she did with a man there about 6 months.
Yeah,
so if she come out in July, she and the G in her things from January. So may I tell you, the poor man there over there, man. That's why the reason why She filed for divorce is not because the man do nothing wrong, because she move on. Yeah. And this is why.
But nothing wrong with that.
No, this man deserve every dollar we him get out of the 1.2
well,
million.
As I said mentally to you,
long time.
As I said to you, he made an investment.
Well, the man did love her. The man really did it as a nice, as a the man. You see, woman, I understand here, is this here, now, Karen?
This
Karen, hold on, man.
Listen to Triple. Listen to Triple.
If it was a woman on the next side, woman, then I jump and I defend the woman and say, she was supportive. She was there. She helped him. She was in the background. Working to ensure
of
that
course.
he was this and this and that. And the same thing the man did, and this woman was was basically based on the information that is placed before us. She was a predator.
Based on
she
the
took
information,
she took advantage of this man while he was a
vulnerable young man.
Based on this, it would really seem that this man, Kasim Netwide, never did anything what a husband should do, provide and protect. You understand? Because if he was providing, then she would say, okay, you need to pay me X, Y, and Z. You understand? So this
Somebody can ask you a question.
Hold on, man. If Kasim Net, you understand, he knew that he could groom this woman. Him no say him could, as you said, it was a predator, you know. Mm-hmm. So him make sure same profile her, him marry her. Mm-hmm. You understand it? And in about a year or so, him realize, say, okay, no, you know, because you can't get a divorce less than 2 years. You understand? So the trouble in paradise start and whatever the case is, and him no say within that divorce decree now, yeah, him can put in him share, him want him 1.2, and him good. Good investment on him.
Karen,
I didn't know what he was doing.
Karen, I'm not telling Lena. Karen,
she have a different woman today.
What do you mean?
You need to play netball. You need to play basketball, volleyball, anything. We have to stretch out because you're reaching. You're really reaching.
And you are reaching as well. When you said that this man
Karen,
was a good man.
I'm going to allow you to make your window.
This man was not a good man.
I'm going to allow it to the court of public opinion. People are going to take a quick commercial break and come right back here.
All right.
You're tended.
Time for a new look. And high time to get serious about protecting our home and investment.
It's time to choose BH Paints with over 60 years experience in quality paint finishes. Their products are superior and long-lasting.
Time to check them out.
Ask about BH Paints 100% Acrylic Ultima Plus paint and primer in one. Experience rich colors with advanced UV and mildew-resistant technologies independently tested by experts. What are you waiting for?
Visit a BH Paints Color Center today.
Know your numbers and take control.
Message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
What was that?
Music a play and the people a rock. Woo. Everybody asks for the calico jack. Cups up, make a party. Rum punch, send it my way.
What you know?
Fruit punch mixed with the rum. Link up, my friend, them know. Hey. Sipping on the vibe, yeah, we happy. Calico jack, and then we started. Music a play and the people a rock.
Watch out.
Everybody asks for the calico jack.
Are you mean?
Cups up, make a party. Rum punch, send it my way.
Nationwide 90 FM, the station for the very latest in news and current affairs, will broadcast live the national budget debate presentations from March 12 to 26. The presentations begin March 12 when the Minister of Finance and the Public Service, the Honorable Dr. Nigel Clark, puts forward the government's plans to finance the budget for 2024 to 2025. The opposition spokesperson on finance, Julian Robinson, will make his presentation on March 14. The leader of the opposition, Mark Golding's contribution is on March 19. And the Prime Minister, the Most Honourable Andrew Holness, will make his presentation on March 21. The Finance Minister closes the debate on March 26. That's the 2024-2025 Budget Debates, live on Nationwide 90 FM. As a result of our live coverage of the 2024-2025 Budget Debate presentations, the E-Zone will not be aired on March 12, 14, 19, 21, and 26, and the Sound Off will be aired from 1 to 2 p.m. on these days.
Yeah, frost, man, chop my mind by now. Yeah. Me a chop my mind by now. I'm in a business. Me a do things. Rough up, we no care who fix. We no care who fix. Yeah, frost, man, chop my mind by now. Yeah.
What you think? What you feel? Talk your mind.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you something. You see the people out there were single right now? On a salt.
I'm very sorry.
Uno is very sorry. The people who don't have nobody right, you know.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for uno.
I am. But you know.
I'm not saying no good somebody no out there. No. Yeah. I'm not saying no everybody bad. But you see, because the dating pool is so contaminated, the good stir up with the bad. Mm-mm. So it hard for you to decipher what is good from what is bad.
It's like freshwater fish and saltwater fish together.
Yeah.
But prayers working them. We pray.
May I tell you, say sometimes because and then some of the good people are so scarred and have so many traumatic experiences.
Yeah.
Them start have to display negative attributes.
Yes.
Before you can get to them.
It's very sad.
And then oh, it go over there, so 90% of the time what look good is crosses in the dating pool. Here we are going. People are gonna play that video, yeah.
No, ready? Not all that blings is good.
Zane, we are gonna play that video, yeah? And then on us. We're gonna discuss it after. For the persons on the radio, take a listen. For the persons on IG.
Yeah.
And
here we go.
On YouTube. Watch and listen.
YouTube, go and listen, please. Radioland, please listen to this. Because we need you to call in and let us know what's going on. We got a clip.
Come with me on a date with a guy that I met on Tinder.
All right.
So I've been texting this guy for a while and you know, we'll talk and we're good and everything. Mm-hmm. So he decided that he wanted to take me out on a date. And I said, no problem. So I'm sending him a location. He's from Kingston and I'm from St. Catharines. So we went to Clarendon for this date. You know, so when we go up on the toll, the boy, no money. We pay the toll. I have to dip in my pocket and pay the toll. Anyways, this is me annoyed. No, no, come here. Say, one boy, really? Really have to pay the toll? Anyways, guys. I'm some father what I want. My other loaded fries, hamburger, and my other pasta. When the bill come now, the boy gotta tell me say, I gotta tell the waiter say I want a separate bill.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
Separate bills.
And remember, mind you, when he said when he don't have no money, you know, to pay the toll.
I first red flag that.
Come like a goom.
Oh, yeah, go home if you don't go through it all.
You go back, you turn around, you turn around.
You can't turn back.
No, you know that. You have to pay to go through. Mm-hmm. And then why are you not going back to dinner?
But you see, you have to pay to go through.
It's all right. Mute that investment. It's okay. Because my vibe already gone. We're not going to hit you. We got you saying triple.
First of all.
And then we come back.
For the people who do not know what Tinder is.
Yeah.
Tinder is not a dating app. Tinder is a hookup app. Yeah. You understand? It's a hookup app.
Yeah.
It's a thank you, mom, and go app. It's an app for you to meet persons who want to have conjugal arrangements or conjugal affairs with you. That's what it is for. It is not for somewhere for you to find nice, good, well-thinking, well-wishing individuals. That's not
or
what it's
find
for.
Marriage and love.
That's not
Triple
what it's for.
Has but just... So therefore, hold on the rise. Hold on, and then you're going to jump in. Based on that information that Triple has just given to me, then I take back my statement. I recount my statement. I'm very, very sorry. Go ahead.
Big up Radio Land and big up everybody online. Not necessarily it's just for, you know, hookups. A lot of people, them put on them profile what them look for. So, they, like the people them who are look for actual love and them want a relationship and commitment, them put it on them profile and
I didn't.
This is what I want. You understand what I mean? So, we don't really know what were the circumstances around these two people, you know, getting together. But she said they must speak for a while. So, if they are speaking for a while, I think that should have been enough time for her to investigate what kind of guy this person is.
But how she do that online?
No, even if you're supposed to can pick up certain things, even if you want to tell lie.
Okay.
You see what I say? Like, you're supposed to can you know,
inconsistencies.
From him demeanor, how him.
Rasen, can I ask a question?
It's supposed to pick up certain things.
Rasen, The question I'm going to ask is this simple. If you go somewhere and you see a man turn over a bad pan or the basin with all of the chicken where he does fry up on the ground. And you see him take up that chicken there and chew it back in the bale with the good chicken them. You still go on him serve chicken out of the bale and chew that chicken up on figure?
No.
So if you know say the chicken them have a possibility say them contaminated and dirty, why you go expect for say when you get your share of the chicken, a good chicken you go get uncontaminated chicken.
Your analogy, where are you? Use it for describe
may
Tinder?
I describe it for you? Use it for describe Tinder.
No, but now, hold on.
I'm not saying, everybody. As we say on this show, we deal with probabilities, not possibilities. If you know, say, the majority of the man them over there, or most of the man them over there, I look for somebody where them can just have a quick hookup. Why you as a woman will want a good man?
Depende
I look somebody and right, expect to find that. Hold on. You see, I understand, say, one out of every 1,000 person might go out there and find a relationship and something come out of it, you know. But me, I got to tell you this. If you are go over this, if you go look somebody, you're kind of dark.
Yeah. So you're saying Tinder is not the place to meet somebody and go. I have a 1 in 1,000 here, Traz. I have a 1 in 1,000 here who said that her friend met somebody on Tinder and they are now married. I don't know what the status is of that marriage, but that is probably the 1 in 1,000. Traz, right. what say you about that?
I'm not going to say it's a 1 in 1,000. Like, okay. Initially when the app came out, I believe that was what the app was for. Like, you know, but it kind of grew into this more of a dating site in 2024.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that people don't use it to hook up, but people do actually use it to find meaningful relationships. And I'm saying that even now, you see, if you were to probably scroll, you'd probably see a lot of corporate people on there who are look for love. Okay. You understand?
Hey,
so that means a triple.
No,
you probably know it for where it was initially.
Razzy.
Launch for,
Razzy.
But no, in a 2024 is something completely different.
Razzy, me nah say people over there look for love, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But me, I tell you, say the majority of people over there, right now, first of all, let me tell you something. First of all, most people nah look for relationship right now. Most people are look for financial arrangements.
You mean people in general? Well,
people in general. Most, a lot, well, me nah say most, a lot of women now are looking for financial benefactors, and men are looking for persons who can give them their vertical smile. Yeah. That's what they're looking for. You understand?
Yeah.
When you set and put it in a dating app, let me talk about in the physical world now. You see, when you go over there, so now, in the dating app, even though people are going, you know, because first of all, a woman will try to find a man, any man at all, now I'm going to put it up. I am here for casual encounters. She going to put it up, say she's looking for something rational and put them thing there because she want to attract the best of the best.
Well, some of them put say, oh, them are look for short term.
I understand, said yes, they do that because you have some persons who are openly going to do that, but it is still taboo to express yourself as such. So, when you're over this, and you as a man now, Razzy, if you are going to try to pick, and you are going to want, are you going to want a used shoe or a brand new shoe? If you look at shoes so wear, you're going to want a brand new shoes, right? So when you go over there now, you not going to want to come take up the one that we are looking for casual. You're going to say, boy, that one, they probably rev out in a car, only for casual it get. You're going to want to look for the one where you're going to say, oh, them want something long term. Because you're going to say, oh, probably that one is more discriminatory.
Okay.
And you can get it less people use that one. Some of my sex and try for that one. Even though you yourself want short term use. So you basically are a butter in a puss mouth. You can't vex any puss bite you.
No, you know, me look pan still triple.
Which
why
is
me
why.
Look pan it there?
Yes, right.
Because, you see, if you have a look pan it and talk about who do the most or who is used the most. Remember, you know, we live in a highly
sexualized society. Yes.
You know
yes.
what I mean?
Okay.
So, them thing there, people expose them thing there from as young as 14, 15.
Young.
You know, and people doing that stuff from them under the age
understand.
Of for do it. So, me not think, say, you know, Tinder in itself is a good, you know, catalog or a good place really use for judge, you know, people and, you know, their morals and so on and so forth. I'm a think Instagram worse. And people date people from Instagram. People look for what people have on Instagram. I think Instagram is a worse place to find somebody to be with, you know. You know, but it's still held on this pedestal. You understand what I'm saying?
The truth of the matter is social media. Alright, if you check the statistics, 60% of relationships now are started on social media, whichever platform it is. Because that's where persons are socializing most.
Yeah, okay.
But certain app where you dip on. Mm-hmm. You understand? When you go on certain app, you know what it's about. The majority of persons know what it's about.
All right, let me jump in a second. People need to realize now, as Triple just said, this is the new way of dating. People want to meet somebody. It is in their head, it's a safe space, meaning me not have to go look and go fish in public or whatever the case is. I can put a profile up. I can tell them what I'm looking for, and then it will spit back how many people would be interested in me.
We're going to take a quick commercial break and then come back. We still analyze the video yet.
No, so we'll come back to it, man. Me talk about.
Stand out among competitors. Show your commitment to quality. Submit your entry in the Bureau of Standards Jamaica National Quality Awards Program. Your entry provides the opportunity for a free comprehensive assessment of your organization's management system and facilitates improvement in effectiveness and efficiency. This prestigious award associates your organization with performance excellence. Step into a world of excellence. Gain access to international markets. Enter today.
Call 618-1534. The Bureau of Standards Jamaica, making standards work for you.
It's time for a new look.
And high time to get serious about protecting our home and investment.
It's time to choose BH Paints with over 60 years experience in quality paint finishes. Their products are superior and long-lasting.
Time to check them out.
Ask about BH Paints 100% Acrylic Ultima Plus paint and primer in one. Experience rich colors with advanced UV and mildew resistant technologies, independently tested by experts. What are you waiting for? Visit a BH Paints Color Center today.
Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Don't stop at just a one slice, please. No other bun, perfect for
give me.
Me
yummy.
For real Jamaican flavor and quality for sure this Easter. Make yummy the bun to your cheese.
Yummy.
Give me yummy.
Yummy.
Give me yummy. For the Easter. Yummy bunzita. Yummy for me family. Yummy for me, sir. Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Bun to me cheese.
Bun to me cheese.
Best bun.
Give me yummy.
Come with me on a date with a guy that I met on Tinder. So I've been texting this guy for a while and, you know, we talk and we're good and everything. So he decided that he wanted to take me out on a date. And I said, no problem. So I'm sending him a location. He's from Kingston and I'm from St. Catharines. So we went to Clarendon for this date. And I know, so when we go up on the toll, the boy, no money. We pay the toll. I have to dip in my pocket and pay the toll. Anyways, this is me and I don't know. Come and say, one boy, really? Really have to pay the toll? Anyways, guys. I'm some father what I want. My other loaded fries, hamburger, and my other pasta. When the bill come now, the boy I got to tell the waiter say I want a separate bill.
All right, guys. So this is now what we're talking about. We're talking about expectations. We're talking about dating sites. We're talking about what really happens in the minds of men and women and what happens on dating sites. Dating sites are now for everybody else who's out there and saying, me not going on no dating site and what happens and that blah blah blah. That is where it's at. People are now socializing more on the computer. People are socializing on their phone. People are socializing. It's also a way of weeding out. But then again, it does not replace really how you weed out somebody in a physical interaction. No. What I'm saying is, whether you can, what's the name? Catfish. You can catfish all you want and so on. But sometimes, as Razzie just said a while ago, sometimes there are red flags when people talking to you, you know. You know, and you know that there are some inconsistencies. And because once you start to tell a lie, you have to remember the lie that you have told. And then know, you know, it is a lot of work. All right, fine. This lady now, as Triple just said, when you go on Tinder, there is a certain expectation. Tinder is a hookup site. There are some of people, there are many among us, who have found their love, and we don't know how that relationship going, but they have found something. But for general, what we're saying is Tinder is a hookup site, right? I am saying now, ladies, understand when it is that you go on these sites, don't think that you are going out there for your Prince Charming. Please manage your expectations. Do not go in there, get what you get, and then come out and say, what is? No, you signed up for that. You knew exactly what you are doing. Please, ladies, stop changing the script in your head because to make it more palatable. You knew exactly what you're doing. You're not a victim. You know what I mean? If it is that you want to meet a upstanding somebody and go and you know, ride off to the sunset with your Prince Charming and get married and have kids and the picket fence and all of that, maybe Tinder is not the site. You understand? Maybe it is that you need to go somewhere, meet somebody physically, you know, make sure that they're vetted properly, or go to a professional matchmaker where you know that person is vetted properly. But if it is now, another red flag, you and this youth in the car and you go to the toll and the man says, "I'm not have no toll." Where are you going? Even if it is that you are, because this to me sounds like desperation. It really does.
No, right, hold on. Hold on there 1 second.
Then. Yeah.
Because, all right. People, if you understand, a modern time now. Number one, what if a red flag in this? From before she even meet the man.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, you just meet a man, you never meet a man before. I have left from where? Your yard, a Portmore. Got Clarendon.
Mm-hmm.
With a man we don't know from nowhere. Mm-hmm. In a vehicle with him by yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Big red flag that is very careless to me. Second of all, the toll not even so bad. Because sometimes you can go up on the toll and you don't have no cash because they don't take card at the toll. So paying the toll.
They do now.
Them do now.
Oh, okay. As a matter of fact, them, you know what they take too? That same Clarendon toll? Debit card.
All right. Mm. So, okay. Me never even know that.
Oh, yeah.
First of all. So, all right. Boom. The man now pay the toll. Fine. Red flag this. Zain, you go at the restaurant to the person. Zain, first of all, from the person said them now I'm paying a toll. You're supposed to look at them and say, how is it that you come? That's supposed to start a conversation for you start talk right there. So for hear the person's intention. When the person if you know how the person pockets and all them something. If the person gonna tell you say, them intend to pay for them own food and you not paying them, that is not a date anymore. You and the person just at par and a chat. You understand? You have to pay for your own food. So you decide whether or not you're willing to continue the date from right there. So it's either, sir, carry me back home, or sir, left me at Old Harbor, because the toll come before Old Harbor. Left me at Old Harbor, so maybe take something and go back to my yard. Or come off of me a pen and go back to your yard. You understand me? I say, Zain, you make up your mind from there, so you are going to sit down and wait and allow the person to order food, order everything, and then you are going to wait till the separate being and they are going to complain, sir. You have to understand, there is no way, I'm still going to go back to that Tinder app something. You can't sit down on a gully bank and throw your line with bait and expect to catch a parrot. All you're going to catch is ticky-ticky and gully mullet. You're not going to get no good fish over there. You understand me, I say? So you sit down over this and put yourself in a situation for make mad. Yes, the man is a... You have to remember this, you know, in this modern day time, you know. Enough man, me know, go out with woman. I want woman to pay for them own food, you know. You know, for the first date, you know.
And that's not a good thing to do.
It's not good for our generation because we grow better.
Yeah.
But you have to remember, this generation now is very transactional.
Yes. All right, fine. So people, when she says, and there's a comment here in YouTube which says, Karen, he invited her out, so how is she desperate? Honey child, desperation is written all over that. If it is now that he invited you out, if he invites you out, then whoever is the inviter pays for the invitee. You understand? So if you going to go to the toll and him going to push an impact and say, boy, me not have money to pay for toll, you know, that is a serious where you go? You understand what I'm saying? Turn the car around and go to your yard, because nothing else, the vibe already spoiled. Then nothing else can come from that. So what, everything else you get from that now is you. It's on you. You can't come now, and unless it's likes you want and followers or whatever the case is, just to tell a story. But this is not on the man. This is on you, the woman. And hold on, Razi. I know you have a point. All I'm saying is, ladies, know what you are doing. Don't set up these men and then come back and say, oh, him should have did, him should have did, whatever the case is. You saw the flags. You went for it. And then you hope. This is lunacy, because it is now that you saw everything, you know. And as a matter of fact, she must have seen red flags before this, right? She must have.
No,
yeah,
no.
Yeah, man. I'm
no,
telling you.
Because when I'm gonna talk, you have to remember this. Karen, yeah. A long time I'm on the dating market. You see them man.
Oh, you mean a long time?
A long time I'm on the dating. Remember, you're married woman and you're second long, long time. I see them man nowadays. Them man are coming like wolf in a sheep cloak. Them man are known for deceive. A crook lizard.
I understand that.
Any surface them go on, them can blend in. Them woman are twin up. Them nobody
is. If you have a discerning spirit, you can tell. But then again, there's not much of us who have discerning spirits these days, because we're on other things.
I agree with you that I think that she might be desperate, because, you know, as Oweed said earlier, because she had talked to this man. I think that there might have been red flags, but, you know, because, you know, she caught up in at the moment with this person.
Razi,
you know, she just looked past
I
the red flags.
I am telling you that.
So I
kind
of feel like, yeah.
Yes, and you have that 150%. Women these days, women yesterdays, women way back when, what women do, we try to flip the script, turn something else in our head and say, no, it's not that bad, just because they want a different outcome.
The desperation that she's desperate for is love.
Is love. She exactly. So love. Why can't we love ourselves? Why can't we take a chance on ourselves? Why can't you can't take it? Why is it now that you have to meet somebody on Tinder? First of all, Triple, did you know that whenever it is that you're meeting somebody for the first time and you're going on, you go to a coffee shop in the day. You understand? And then you have your friend to call you.
That's
you have your friend to call you.
Yeah. Karen.
And you have your money in your pocket.
Karen, at 2024 now.
Yes.
You see, hold on. You see that 2024, women have been, our people have been acclimatized to a different thing. People are more experience driven. You understand me? I say, most of the people, when they think about date, it's not about meeting the person and getting to know the person. Most people, when they talk about going out with somebody, are the experience them think about, you know.
Yeah.
Once upon a time, a date for you, as we say, could have just go to one coffee shop, go sit down and chat, go up a Devon's, go buy two ice cream and walk up and down on the lawn, go up a open garden and walk up and down, and then something.
No,
like,
a date for me was jump on a private jet and go to
auntie. Well, I know, Karen, we're not reach over this yet.
That's a date.
We are talking about originally what dating was about, getting to know the person.
Yeah.
Nowadays, when you care with a woman, not for the woman, them ask, them want to figure ambrosia.
All right,
them want
so what them is the experience? If you
have not paid it to them want to go over Chucka Cove Adventures. They want to go skydiving. They want to go first date. Them thing.
First,
them.
No.
Yo, Razi, you not going to do it, you know, Razi. But Razi.
No, I know my people out there do it.
Now. Razi, me I tell you this, all the things set right. I know. You see, the man them out there were single. Or the man them out there, I look on Instagram every day.
Desperate.
You see, enough of the, you see, what the problem is, a lot of the people, them, enough of the people them out there, them lost now this hyper-fantasization with social media give them. Social media tell them, say, this is what it is supposed to be, so this is what they expect.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so when the woman here say, all right, here, we're going on a date, we're going to drive out, and we're going to go to the thing we catch her, no, she has never been to the restaurant there before.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a drive out, and then probably the man profile and show some opulence. Mm-hmm. Same as a brafa, him have a nice car, and all this
from inside
and she has said, oh, the boy fit the demeanor, how she wants, slim, athletic looking, whatever, tall, and she says, all right, boom, look good, everything, all of the boxes are checking, plus he want carry a guy somewhere exotic, somewhere you never been before.
Yeah.
You understand?
Check.
And she jump on the wagon there, because it wasn't about knowing the person, it was about the experience.
But the experience turn over, and the uppercut turn over when them pass the tool.
Them done
that is all I'm saying, them done in another
nobody. Still at work for the best.
Still at work. I am so sorry with the Pollyanna attitude. Pollyanna, you know, it's a Pollyanna. Oh, I wish for a wonderful world. She knew exactly what she was getting herself into.
I know, Triple, like, you're absolutely right. And we, as a people, we need to move from that. We need to get back to
get
root
back
of
to.
The thing. You
get
know,
back
you want
to
find
when
out
we,
if you're on somebody compatible.
When we need...
So you do the simple things first. You understand?
Yeah.
Because me not gonna take up somebody with me, because I don't even know if I like you. So I'm not gonna spend a big money
it's
for
a speed
you for the first
date.
Time.
Razzy, go to a coffee shop.
Razzy, how much, Razzy?
I'm 34.
You're 34, Razzy.
Mm-hmm.
You see, back in a year, remember say you start look woman before WhatsApp. Remember say you look woman from your office send 100 texts.
From chat room.
You understand from chat room and party line and them thing there.
Yeah.
You understand from before 100. So you actually could have see a woman face to face and conversate and exude some level of charisma for try to get for appeal to the woman better nature.
Okay.
So you have that little groove there already. You see them nowadays youth ya.
Yeah.
Enough of them nowadays youth ya. Them only see what them see upon the internet or upon the grammar upon the social media. Them believe say it is how them look, how them dress, what them drive and how much money them have get woman. Enough of them don't know what a personality is. You ever, right now, sometimes I go to some restaurant and I look and I see the people. You say, oh, they are restaurant? Them not chat. Then they sit down on them phone.
No, because they're socialized
food.
On their phone.
Them don't know how to talk to each
exactly.
other.
Exactly.
Them just sit down
and socialized on their phone.
Them don't know if you have a conversation. So it's all about
content
gathering.
So, to your point, this is the new dating. This is the new scene. This is how it is. This is not even the future.
Normal.
This is the new normal. Thank you very much. COVID word. This is the new normal. So if this is the new normal, then the new normal is no longer good. Ladies, please re-raise your daughters. Understand and please stop letting them just it's like there is no standard. There's absolutely no standard. There's always all it is in this lady's head and in many other females' head is what they think is going to come based on what they
what
think in
get,
their head and what
them
what
can,
them
get.
Can get. It is wrong. You are putting your security and your safety at risk.
People, I just hope to learn something from this video now. It's not about for laugh off of the people them. We just point out about 40 different ways this could have gone left.
Mm-hmm.
You understand me?
Which
I say
it did go.
You have to remember this, you know. You have to remember this, you know. You say when you interact with somebody where you don't know, you're putting yourself and them things in
risk.
At risk. Mm-hmm. You understand? We have to remember this. The world that we live in, it is not cotton candy and it is not coated with sugar anymore. People, we are going to take a quick commercial break.
Right back.
And we are going to circle back with what's on the lunch menu.
280-6629. Please send in your food. Send it in early. Already, it's too late. But send it in anyway. And don't blame us if the food don't feature. Please. All right. So.
You better go buy Duba.
You don't need no other.
You have a couple thing money can buy love. You better go buy Duba. You have a couple thing money can buy love. You better go buy Duba. You have a couple thing money can buy love. You better go buy
Duba. Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Don't stop at just a one slice, please. No other bun, perfect for
give me. Yummy.
For real Jamaican flavor and quality for sure this Easter. Make yummy the bun to your cheese.
Yummy.
Give me yummy.
Yummy.
Give me yummy. For the Easter, yummy bunzita. Yummy for me family. Yummy for me, sir. Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy.
Bun to me cheese.
Bun to me cheese.
Best bun.
Give me yummy.
Catch the E-Zone with me, the Stinger Honey Bee, alongside
Kareem Boy Ting.
As we turn up the heat in the street.
New show,
new vibe,
Same us.
Monday
to Friday,
3 to 5 p.m. Right here on Nationwide 90 FM.
We'll bring you entertainment news.
We'll take away your Monday blues.
You don't want to miss a week with us.
We'll talk health.
Well,
jump into the mix.
Or the hot seat.
Don't miss the brain buster.
Or the crazy giveaways.
I mean, is this planet Earth?
Is it?
I don't know, let me check. Either way, it's got a buzz.
Do you have a consumer-related issue? Want to learn more about matters concerning you as a consumer? Well, keep it locked to Nationwide 90 FM for the Consumer Hour with me, Nora Gay Banton, weekdays from 9 to 10 a.m. For all your consumer-centric matters, stay tuned to the Consumer Hour on Nationwide 90 FM, a revolution in media.
People, me have something to tell you now. A long, long time me a wait. But see, the time is right, time is now. Me turn the stove down low. And just pull the windows open. I'm in the mood, so me not go spoil it. Bet you are gonna want me cook again. Saying, ooh, it's been a long, long time. I'm cooking some ackee for you, girl. But it seems like you never like rice. So I'm gonna get some flour first. And I want to give you some good.
It's lunchtime. What's on your lunch menu?
See? I am looking forward to some beautiful food today. It is Tuesday. It is Troublesome Tuesdays. Give me some trouble. No? Give me some trouble with the food. Yeah. What we have up? What we have? What we have? What we have? Yeah. I'm looking for some nice looking food. What is this? Boy, this fish just look like it's pure black pepper. Like it blackened. Oh, Lord. Mercy.
All right. This is jerk fish.
Oh, it's jerk
fish. Jerk fish with fried bam. I say, now cook with now heap of seasoning. So it's just, when a heap of juice or sauce, this is jerked fish. Mm-hmm. You understand? So the fish basically cooked in its own juices pan almost an open flame. So this is from Rocky Point. You understand? This actually tastes good.
Rocky.
You understand?
Point.
It actually tastes good because okay. Actually not a sauce and them something. The vegetable kind of sparse as well. You understand? Zane?
Rocky, you need to come back home. I think Rocky Point need to come back to them family. Them need to come back to us. Yeah.
So, me I go get this. Me I go get this one 9 out of 10. Because I like jerk fish. Me personally like jerk fish. Me not really like fry. Me not like fried bami still, you know. You see, if I do a jerk fish, I still like my bami steamed. So I'd rather cook down my fish and I like cook down my bami in a steam fish. I give him a jerk fish.
Rocky Point, I can't even say, well, maybe they started jerk to fish, eat. Maybe that, you know, but it just don't look appealing. I'm very sorry. It look very sparse.
Uh-huh.
You understand what I'm saying? Where is like, we just, you know, throw the vegetables in one side and whatever the case.
Yeah, mash up the vegetable already still.
Really? You think so? No, man, something wrong.
The vegetable look move it through.
It look
like move.
Somebody started.
Oh, have mercy. It's an 8. Because you say it tastes good.
Yeah, it tastes good.
Tastes right. Good, man. Yeah, I tell them.
And I would have liked to see like a baked potato. We don't bake potatoes in Jamaica. Like a baked potato.
Not
a
seaside. It's not seaside food, that. And a seaside food, that. Right. Yeah, no, not a sports bar food. You understand? Bar and grill food.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah,
thank you.
Okay.
Anyways, next up.
Baked potato would be very nice with that. Or even sweet potato fries. Seasoned fries. It's regular fries. No. Seasoned fries taste good.
People, do remember, you know. Do remember, you know. What is? Bun and banana chips. Bun and cheese and banana chips.
And
hey.
What kind of banana chips is that?
St. Mary's
banana
Mary. Chips.
St. Mary banana chips. Hey. Yes, and bun and cheese.
Good banana chips then, eh?
No,
you know what? You know what nice? You
what
see, if
nice?
You open the bun and cheese and put the banana chips in the bun and cheese, me I tell you, it get a little crunchy. It changes the texture. All right. Bun, you see, Easter bun is a very universal thing, you know. For those, if you know, you know. If you know, you know. And big up to St. Mary's banana chips, though.
Yes, St. Mary's, big up to you. Every day, all day.
I am winning right now. YouTube, big up on yourself.
I am winning.
Sending this.
I am winning sending this. Really?
Bossy.
Okay.
Bossy.
Yeah.
Bossy.
Very creative. It's a very, very, very creative launch.
Nice.
Yes, with a lot of crunch and texture. And of course, we're looking forward to the good Easter bun.
Yeah, so that bad with some
lemonade.
Some cola champagne.
Some drinks.
Syrup.
Drinks.
With a jigger of ginger.
Drinks.
Right, that's so.
No, they expect that.
Drinks. That is it. May I tell you, I would mash that up. But I'm going to give this a 10.
Chips.
For
there
those who know, no.
A 9.5 for me. Yeah.
If you know.
And you know what I like about St. Mary's? They always have banana. There is another banana chips company out there, you see, which foundation banana chips with a red and white thing. Yeah, that one. Banana shot all the time. Is that what I'm saying? St. Mary's can't get banana. So St. Mary's, big up to you for your
because
consistency.
Because
they
have the one St. Mary that grow banana right through the year.
The
and they stack up all them. Next up for me, please, Auntie Jerry.
Yeah, but the foundation one. Could I say, all right, Michael, go buy some banana from St. Mary's.
Yeah. So, watch out now.
Here we go.
Jerry, you know say I itch though? How far nine night this? Ufa webinar. A function food. This a food.
Rosalind said, Jerry, Rosalind said, you need to find her food and send it in and send it up.
So
put it up. Put it
curry
up.
Goat. Curry goat.
That's curry goat?
Yes, curry goat in the middle. That look like pork. I don't know what kind of pork. If a pot roast, a jerk pork.
It would have looked like pot roast to me.
Pan the side.
Uh-huh.
that look like white
potato
rice
salad
up there.
No, potatoes. No, it's white rice. It's white rice. White with rice canned and vegetables. Sweet corn.
All right. I'm going to tell you, man. Pot roast pot, curry goat, potato salad, tossed veg with fruit, corn on the cob, and a glass of tang. Whatever I keep in your yard, I'm sorry I never get invited.
A big thing's going on this one.
Big things, yeah.
And the pork. Zoom in on the pork.
Actually, you know what? This look like triple. It look Christmas. You know, like you're going Christmas dinner. Maybe it's because of the pot roast. Is pot roast, you said? Is it pot roast?
Yeah, pot roast pork. Zoom in there. Zoom in there for me.
It look kind of holiday-ish.
Me and tell this man.
It's a holiday situation going on there.
Look on the pork cook right through. Evenly. Look pan the consistency of fat or the fat the pork lean. Look how the pork lean and nice, brother. Soak right through and look moist and hey, this
boy,
is a
curry goat
alone. Curry goat bossy, brother. The curry goat boss with the Irish them and bungs and thing man and broad bean and it. Oh god. Hey. Me I give this one 10 still no. But now I go around, you know. But now girl, you know, but not going around.
Take
half
this a
ten,
point for me still.
Yeah. So we're going to give it an 8.5 for me.
May I give it a 10, you know?
Yeah, may I give it an 8.5.
May I give it a
10? Because it looks very filling. It's a lot of texture there. A lot of work went into this meal, you know. You know what I mean? There's a whole heap of things going on here in the little plight. But it's an 8.5 for me.
May I give it a 10 still? I'm sorry, not carried, but may I take a... Yeah, I give it a 10. Right now, mash it up. Right now, destruction. How about this? Rice and peas.
And what?
It's a toast salad.
And what is that?
I don't know the little piece I'm sitting up. This look like a piece of yam. And what kind of meat?
But what kind of meat is this?
Oh, well, if I grew up with this pan of food, there still no.
What?
Look, I want chicken breasts.
No.
How about this?
Unidentified.
Yes. Is a pot roast pork this?
No. No, you're reading the wrong description, Jerry. This can't be pot roast pork. Wait, what?
All right, let me tell you, them pot roast the pork and then cook down the sauce and chew it on it, you know.
But where's the pork?
But what?
See pork there?
I don't feel well.
Let me tell you how about this. Let me tell you what part I pork this. Let me tell you, slice the shoulder and roast it. Like, no, not the hack. The pork hack. And, like, you know, the part above the foot. Oh. Like, the pork hack, them use and cook this. It look to me. If I bone that, like the hack. You understand? I don't know. Or probably I just owe the picture thick. But it does not look. It don't look so nice, too appealing.
But because it's food, I'm going to give it a 5.
And I whole heap of gravy this, bro. You got to tell you.
Yeah. Are you telling me that's gravy to the left of the plate? Yeah. All of that right there? That's accumulated. That's like gravy?
This is flavor pressure.
You know, I would say take out the meat and then you would have something, you know, that you can build on.
I give that 7.
5 because it's food.
I give that 7.
Jereen, Roslyn Stewart say you must find our food, please.
The rice look good still. Vegetable look good still, but me I tell you, the pork does throw me off, man.
Like
a cure. When I can't send a picture of them in the middle of the show, guys. Now, if you send a picture of them from early, me I beg you to please. Because remember I said the phone where I use, it not so new.
You know what I'm saying? You know, it's a foundation, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, it's a 7 for me. What you say?
You know a pork, so. I'll get a 6.5.
No, man, a 5.
All right.
I'm not a fighter. There's a question asking if this person is Bajan. Bajan people cook different?
Yeah, Bajan people cook them pork white.
Okay. Okay.
All right, now this not look bad. What is a fried sweet
potato? All right,
potato.
So what is that? Oh.
Fried sweet potato. A rice and peas, star salad.
Carrot juice?
And this look like a piece of barbecue or jerk chicken.
Mm-hmm.
This look like carrot juice.
Uh-huh.
Or if I'm a cup carrot juice, a papa juice.
Carrot.
It look good still, no? This look good, enough. You know?
This is decent. This is nice.
But now I'm telling you, I give this one 9.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of juice? Jerry?
You look like carrot.
It look like carrot.
It juice look the best out of fruit punch. It look like it's either fruit punch, carrot juice, or papaya juice.
Whatever it is, it's
it
a nice
good
combination
it look
going
real
on there.
Good, man. Juice look refreshing. I drink some of that.
Yeah, I like
and the juice.
The,
I bring the meal to me. Still.
I like the texture. The sweet potato. That sweet potato is a fried sweet potato. Yeah. And the rice and peas looks really good. And the chicken look good too. And the tossed veg look good. Everything just look good.
The food that I want some gravy still. Me not go wrong.
No, you don't need no gravy with that.
You need gravy with the fried potato, man. Oh, God, man.
No, you don't need
me
much.
I look good. Me not see no gravy upon the rice, bro.
No gravy in the feed.
No gravy in the pan of meat. Me not see. No, just the rice. The rice. No gravy in the pan of rice. The rice does cook soft. And a shelly rice, this. The rice. Me love the rice.
Uh-huh.
The vegetable look good. The potato look good, the chicken look good, but it want a little gravy. Baked chicken, say so that want a little
the rice
chicken
and peas upon further inspection looks a bit like soupy. It looks like it was, yeah.
Oh, it, yeah, achoo. See, you can gravy drippings there.
Yeah, see, gravy.
But, yeah.
But it's a clean plate.
Me
you like it.
May I give it a 9 still? Mm-hmm. May I give it a 9?
8.5 for me, because of the rice.
Zin? Frank White, it's a curry gravy. One missing. Thing about Jamaican, I want curry gravy, you know. For anything, you know.
For everything.
Serious to God. Yeah, I'm going to take a quick time signal.
JP said, name is Banana Chips. 20% more chips in the banana. Designed by J.P. St. Mary's Banana Chips is...
It is...
1:58 in the afternoon.
2 p.m. in the afternoon. Thank you.
Look at me, never see y'all look messy up. Sorry.
So, next up. Quick and fast, the journey before they run me.
Oh, yeah, that's going to run. Triple. Okay, with Alize. Why don't you just turn around the thing? No, you know, it needs to turn.
What is?
Yeah, Alize. What's Alize? Is Alize like a champagne cooler, don't it?
Yes, a cooler. Yeah. Once upon a time, hot drinks, man.
What?
Wings and rice and
you
peas.
You are saying nothing if you never drink
for the
Alize.
For the persons at home, the person here surround the rice. With the, I have never seen wings served this way. It's on a square plate.
Yeah.
And them literally.
It's not Jean.
They make an encampment around the rice with the wings and put the rice on the mingle.
This look like it would, whoever this is, and I know it's not Gene, is like a Gene training. You understand what I'm saying? Like Gene would have trained this person as how to garnish their meal and plate it.
What is Chobani?
Chobani is a Greek yogurt. So what I'm asking, you know, is rice and peas in the middle?
What name is Chobani? What is it there? Yogurt?
Yes, it's a Greek yogurt. Chobani. Right. Yeah, it's a Greek yogurt. It's actually very nice. You eat yogurt?
Yeah, mom, eat yogurt.
Okay, fine. But is me not quite understand the meal still. I would have liked to see some tossed vegetables, some little
chicken on the wrap. See them a try for presentation. You know we're gonna give them what eat for this though. We're gonna give them what eat for this.
Mm-hmm.
But now I'm gonna run
this is gene training, I'm telling you.
This is I try. Mm-hmm. But I know but I don't dig it still the presentation still, but the wings them look juicy still, you know. The wings them look juicy still. I'm not going to grow. Them look well seasoned and them.
Very creative. And I like the fact that you put it in a tray. I like the fact that it's bird's eye view. That means you have been listening to us when we said take the pictures properly.
That is it.
You could have rotated it though so we could see the thing properly. I like the fact that you're old school because it's Alize you present to us today. You know? But the rice and peas. Is this in coconut milk? Is it rice in coconut milk?
Yes.
How that tastes?
Rice in coconut milk.
Mm-hmm.
Tastes good.
Yeah.
You understand?
Okay.
Yeah. But anyways,
is your rice Shelly when you...
You have no more over here? We have one more, guys.
Okay.
Remember, so we have a very short show today.
Yeah.
You understand?
And we will not belabor the point. Oh, this don't look bad.
This look good.
This looks nice.
This look good.
This looks nice.
The food that look like it cooked with love.
Yes, and it don't even have no whole heap of gravy cook and it still chicken. Look good. What cooked down fried chicken? That's fish.
Cooked down fried fish, sorry. Cooked down fried fish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You understand the corn look good.
Mm-hmm.
You understand the corn look good.
Very.
The rice and peas look very, very
very
rich.
Good. Yeah.
You understand it? No okra on it, but it have carrot.
It don't need no okra. It don't need any.
It have carrot. Look like me see. No, there's carrot, onion.
Onions. Carrots and onions. And then the sweet toss pepper. Veg on the side. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Fried fish with rice and peas. Raw veg. Sweet corn.
Mm-hmm.
Renee, I'm going to give you. I'm honestly going to give you a 10 for this.
I am giving you a 10 for this.
I'm going to give you a 10 for this.
Shell Boss, what you
this
say?
This look good. This look good.
It's a 9, I'm afraid of the
big
rice
up yourself, Renee.
What do you mean you're afraid of the rice or the fish? Explain. Yeah. I have follow-up
bone.
Questions.
Bone.
Why? The bone?
Bone.
So yes, what do you want to eat with that then? What in place of the rice, what would you put? Since you're afraid of the rice with the fish.
Some crackers.
Fry bummy. Crackers,
festival.
Dumpling.
Festival.
The reason why people don't really eat rice with fish still.
I don't like
it. But a curve of people prefer to eat rice with fish. That means you am too fast.
Fast, yeah.
You understand? And if the fish fry good, you don't have to fret about the bone.
Yeah, for real.
News said this is from... News, are you telling the truth? News said this is from her 19-year-old sister. A 19-year-old cooked this? Yes, then that means that big up my little sister.
Hello,
it's true.
Believe
that means
19-year-old big woman.
Yes, but in these times what we just talked about, the ladies who are the crop, the new crop now, for a 19-year-old to really think about this meal and cook it and execute like this, this girl is a winner.
A big woman.
This girl is a winner. You're not a big woman, you're here.
Big up news.
You're a little sister.
Big up news. Big woman, little sister.
Yeah.
we cook this food here.
Yeah, and you're not growing good. You're growing very well.
You're growing very, very good.
I will forgive you now for the chicken foot. And you have now completely forgiven. Because look like the girl is coming from good stock. Keep up the good work. This is good. You get a 10 from me.
Annie Smith, yes, we say nyam over here. Or I say nyam over here. Let's put it right this side. Zine, ladies and gentlemen.
It's part of our charm.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you very much for sending in on the food. And also, I appreciate it. Without you, without your participation, we cannot do this part of the show without you. Rosalind, darling, exactly. May I beg you please to send in your food early.
Again.
Send it in at the beginning of the show.
And put your
please,
name on it.
May I beg
your
you.
Name on
and
it.
And please
so
remember
look
to send in a
it.
Description of the food and where the food has come from and all them something. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. That was what's on your lunch menu. We're going to take a quick commercial break. And we have a circle right
maybe
back.
We come back. Maybe we won't.
Public sector workers, are you ready? Registration is now open for the exciting public sector debate competition. Gather your teams and register by March 29. Visit publicsectortransformation.gov.jm for registration details or speak to your HR department. The competition is organized by the Transformation Implementation Unit, building a better public sector for all.
It's time for a new look.
And high time to get serious about protecting our home and investment.
It's time to choose BH Paints with over 60 years experience in quality paint finishes. Their products are superior and long-lasting.
Time to check them out.
Ask about BH Paints 100% Acrylic Ultima Plus paint and primer in one. Experience rich colors with advanced UV and mildew-resistant technologies, independently tested by experts. What are you waiting for? Visit a BH Paints Color Center today.
Do you have a consumer-related issue? Want to learn more about matters concerning you as a consumer? Well, keep it locked to Nationwide 90 FM for the Consumer Hour with me, Nora Gay Banton, weekdays from 9 to 10 a.m. For all your consumer-centric matters, stay tuned to the Consumer Hour on Nationwide 90 FM, a revolution in media.
You deserve a beautiful home. Join the expert Karen Booker, your design diva, this and every Saturday at 1 to 2 p.m. here on Nationwide 90 FM. Learn what's really behind the design. Access insights and hacks that'll have your home looking like it was snatched from a magazine cover. From cushions to curtains, choosing colors to carpets, Karen will teach you the secret of the pros. That's the Design Studio every Saturday at 1 p.m. here on Nationwide 90.
Design Lab Home Decor Tips and Design Trends is brought to you by BH Paints. Paint it, love it with BH Paints.
If you send me the location, then I'll be right there. Don't make her come check you, my baby.
So we are now in the design studio. Yes, and we are now in what? BH Paints, who has sponsored the Design Lab, and we tell them thank you. So we have here... Who do we have? Our head boy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. And then we have over there, very distracted, Mr. Jerome Shellboss. Look at him. Here. Okay. So, you know, we're on pins and needles with our show today because the budget will be read. So, you know, at any time, you know, we might be preempted. So I'm just letting you know that.
So we're going to jump right in.
So we're just going to jump right in. Okay. So Triple, you know what these are? For everybody on YouTube, you will see me with a little pot in my hand. It's about 2 ounces. For everybody in Radioland driving around, I have in my hand a little, what you call that, a color pot.
It's not a yogurt.
Right? It is not a yogurt. But then again, you know, sometimes it comes in very delicious colors that you may think that it is yogurt, but it's not.
Uh-huh.
Here's what BH Paint has done. You know, sometimes you go to the you figure you want to paint your room a certain color.
Uh-huh.
You know? So instead, no, you don't have to go and buy the full gallon or a pint. You can just get a little color pot to test on the wall. And you can, and it comes in any color that you want.
Oh.
They will go and they will mix it for you.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh. So it happens. So, you know, so you have, I have a whole heap of them. So one, this one now is a pinky, you know, this one here. Mm-hmm. Then we have a green. It's very good for if you're going to do things like a DIY project, you know, with all these DIY projects on on TikTok, on Instagram, and these things. So if it is now that you're doing a DIY, you don't have to buy the paint no more. You can pull out one of these. Yeah.
So and this can like paint all one shelf?
No, it can. Yeah, it can paint a little one shelf.
A little one floating shelf.
So what you do, you manage your expectations and you say, okay, if I, for $200 or $300, yes, that's all you're going to pay, to mix this little pot, well, maybe I can dream of a project that I can use this up.
And we can do that, if you're not certain about the color where you want on your wall.
Yeah.
And then something, you can put out a square, paint a square.
And that's what
in
it's
a four
for.
Different color on
that's
your wall.
What it's
and they
for.
Just left
right.
It for a week and see which one of them you feel more.
No, remember.
And after you feel, I have had situations where I've bought paint.
Yeah.
And when I done paint, I swear the right, but I like it.
Yeah.
And after the place done paint, 1 week later, I vex.
Here's what you do. When you paint, you're going to paint it in an area where it's well lit. And then you're going to test it morning, noon, and night because it's different light levels when it comes in. You know what I mean? So once you go to the store and you get the little paint on the little swatch, you know, and even if you glue it on the wall and whatever, it's still not going to come out true to you. So I am thinking this is like the perfect solution to everybody who is going to do
a
paint
project. And not to sound bougie. $3 and a money, $3 and one credit. I want $2 credit that.
Oh, you mean not to sound bougie? Is anything wrong with sounding bougie?
No, I mean, I want to sound like me people say, oh, me not sensitive to the people poor. But $300 for know exactly what it is that you want.
It is an investment in your future.
Because
it is an investment in yourself and in your future.
Yeah.
I don't see anything wrong with that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No.
What is Jereen saying?
Jereen is over there. Supposing in this month, I may have to go back again.
So go back again, Jereen.
You spend $12.
Jereen.
You buy four different colors. At least you know for your facts. It better than... Oh,
you know how much for a gallon of
paint? Cheap.
You know how much for a gallon of paint?
And 1 gallon of paint can't pay a room.
Exactly. You're going to take two and a half to 3 gallons depending on... Because you know you're going to do two coats on your paint. Depending on... Hold on. If you are going from dark to light, you make sure so you put that primer on the wall because if you don't put the primer on the wall, it's 3 gallons or even four depending
and plus
on...
plus if you're on them nook... You know, say you have to get one painter, and then the painter will charge about $20,000 per room or $30,000 per room.
Exactly.
So it's a huge investment that for somewhere
exactly.
You're certain about.
Well, you're something you're not sure about. Let me tell you, it's a BH paints, and I like the paints. Now, sometimes, you know, you hear about the low order or no order. These people, they do that as well. They are very sensitive to the environment. It's green paint. That means it has less chemicals in there.
Okay.
Of course, it's going to have chemicals, but the
all
chemical
in a green one,
is
blue.
Green mean eco-friendly.
Oh, environment. Okay.
Environment
okay.
Different. Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Right?
So
yeah. Mm. Yeah.
So,
okay.
People.
There we go.
People.
Price is very reasonable. You can
big up sponsors, BH.
BH paint, yes.
You understand?
It's an abridged...
But unfortunately... Ladies and gentlemen, this is
go.
The end of the show. We're going to see you guys tomorrow. You know, tomorrow is Wellness Wednesday. We walk good. Same time, same place. I don't know. So it's time for the opposition budget to be read.
Yep.
Big up to everybody on the nationwide team. See you guys tomorrow. Same time, same place.
Bye, guys. See you tomorrow.
To Almighty God for all his blessings and for the strength, wisdom, and courage to continue to serve the people of Jamaica on the journey of national development. I invoke words from Psalm 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength. As I commit to stand up for and stand with the Jamaican people. Occasion reminds me that this journey of representation is not one that is taken alone. My wife, my forever shining star, Sandra, stands by my side. Sandra stands by my side and in my support, and I hail her today. Yeah. Our three children and the new delight of our lives, our first grandchild, stand as a reminder of the sense of family that is so important to national development. This occasion also reaffirms the great privilege it is for me to represent the constituents of South St. Andrew. Without whom I would not be here. I thank them and I thank the members of our constituency executive, many of whom are here today, for the great work they do in service to the people of South St. Andrew. And at this point, I'd like to say a special word of congratulations and thanks to two wonderful ladies, Sarah Marshall and Louise Newland, they have been the CDF officer and secretary for the constituency, and they provide amazing, dedicated support to the work of their Member of Parliament. On the 26th of February 2024, they were both elected councillors for the Trenchtown and Admiraltown Division. And Madam Speaker, they did so with great distinction, as they came first and third in voter support out of the entire 228 councillors across Jamaica in the recent local government election. Respect you. Once again, as party leader, I pay tribute to the team of patriots, my comrades in the People's National Party, who are dedicated to the defense of the interests of the people of Jamaica and building a better future for all our people. I wish to express my profound gratitude for your support. I also wish to thank my colleague, members of Parliament on both sides of this House for another vibrant year of engagement. Let us continue to relate with civility in this House, guided by a shared desire to serve our nation. I also wish to thank the clerk and her team of staff here in Gordon House who work steadfastly to support what we do in the nation's parliament. And Madam Speaker, I particularly want to thank the members on this side for their support, their solidarity, and their guidance along our shared journey. Though only 14 out of 63 at this time, we little but with Talawa. To our senators and other members of the Shadow Cabinet and their deputies and their juniors, I acknowledge and thank you for your service and contribution. I've put together an amazing team of young and experienced Jamaicans, representative across a range of demographics and professions, who are focused on the policies and programs that will improve the quality of life of the Jamaican people. Madam Speaker, for the past many months, I've been along the highways and byways of Jamaica. I wish to express my respect and thanks to the team of people within the People's National Party and the Office of the Leader of the Opposition who have supported me in this effort. Jamaica has just completed local government elections, and I want to thank all the voters who came out and exercised their franchise in support of our democratic system of governance. Madam Speaker, it is noteworthy and significant that for all the talk about voter apathy, the total vote cast in this election increased by over 81,000 persons, or 15%, in excess of the total votes that were cast in the 2016 local government elections, moving up from 545,571 voters in 2016 to 626,934 voters in 2024. An increase, as I've said, of 15%. Indeed, until we comprehensively clean up the voters list by a long overdue re-verification exercise, we will continue to underrate and denigrate the vibrancy of our democracy with this prevailing narrative about voter participation. Madam Speaker, I want to congratulate all the mayors and all the other councillors island-wide on both sides of our political system who were successful in the recent elections. And I acknowledge those who were not elected for their courage and commitment in putting themselves forward. I wish to especially thank the majority of elected councillors who come from the People's National Party for their hard work, resilience, and enthusiasm on the very long road that led to these elections. I also want to use this opportunity to assure them that their work has only just begun and that what we are expecting is a high level of representation, accountability, and transparency in their conduct of the people's business. Similarly, the mayors in the seven local authorities now under the jurisdiction of our party have their marching orders. We published a strong and forward-thinking manifesto, and I expect them to ensure that these commitments are kept, especially those that are possible of implementation prior to us assuming government, and to start the implementation right away. And we are happy to share our ideas with the other seven mayors, as we want to see good governance and even development in the local authorities right across the country. And finally, Madam Speaker, all the people of Jamaica who showed us that you are ready again to listen to what we have to offer, who demonstrated a growing belief that better must come, who came out and provided a popular majority in support of our party. We thank you for your expression of confidence in us, and we look forward to engaging you further in the year to come. We not only listened, but we have learned. I learned that we have a very aware and astute electorate who have come to see this government for what it is. Some are still cautious, but most are resolved. Who feels it knows it. The people of Jamaica want change. Madam Speaker, today I will remind Jamaicans of some of the context in which this budget for the coming fiscal year 2024-25 has been crafted. I will then address some real challenges that we found in the budget as presented, and then I'm going to provide you with some of the concrete plans that we will implement when we come to service as Government of Jamaica. I do this knowing that Jamaicans have seen the light. They know that we will be coming back to implement our plans. The people of Jamaica know that there's one thing about ideas. They are best implemented by the people who come up with them. It is time for change, and that is where we are going. We are on the road to change. Madam Speaker, I sat through the 4.5-hour presentation of the Finance Minister, and I am more convinced than ever that this government does not have any intention of tackling the fundamental challenges facing our country. With them, Jamaica will continue along its current path, and the frustrations and hopelessness of the majority of our people will continue to grow. The 2024-25 budget is yet another tinkering budget, not grounded in a vision of development for the Jamaican people. According to their economic model, something will trickle down to the farmer, the teacher, the nurse, the sanitation worker, the hairdresser, and the taxi man. After 8 years, they want Jamaicans to wait even longer for the trickle that might come. Much of what was presented we have heard before. The 6-story hospital at the University of the West Indies was first announced in 2015 by Fenton Ferguson. The Minister of Finance seems to have found the plan in 2020, and it was re-announced. The Jam World and Fort Rocky Entertainment Zone projects have been announced and re-announced several times. In fact, Fort Rocky was named Jamaica's first entertainment zone in October 2017. The customs duty changes on imports were announced on another stage last November. And new garbage trucks and buses were announced in 2020 to much fanfare and ribbon cutting. Meanwhile, Jamaicans are crying that times are too hard, the cost of living is too high, their wages are too low. Young people are crying out for opportunities to further their education and for better job options. Citizens are crying no to corruption and deception, and yes to transparency and truth. And in terms of broken promises and deception, who can forget the 5% growth in 4 years? An impeachment bill in the first 100 days after 2016. The fixed election dates that were never delivered. And Jamaica's greatest wish, sleeping with our windows and doors open. And there are a few new ones, Madam Speaker, that emerged during the local government elections, like converting Clarkstown into a city and Portmore into Little Miami. Mere pie-in-the-sky ideas masquerading as a vision of national development. We live in a country, Madam Speaker, where there is increasing doubt in the impartiality of our institutions, increasing reports of fear of victimization by Jamaicans not aligned to the government, entrenched apathy with Jamaican nationals losing hope, who feel there's no recourse, no justice, and no point in participating in the political systems or exercising their franchise. Clouds of uncertainty and concern regarding the rights and freedoms of Jamaican citizens on a range of issues from beach access right through to states of emergency. An absence of accountability for wrongdoers aligned to the government. The militarization of the constabulary. All of this is the manifestation of a tendency towards our autocratic rule that I've spoken about year after year, right here in this budget presentation. That is the untenable foundation upon which the country is being run. The main idea of this budget exercise was leveraging economic stability. But that is not something that the other side can claim ownership of. That was a seed that was sown and nurtured by the People's National Party while in government. After the utter chaos brought about by the JLP administration of 2007 to 2011. Let me remind you, since you keep bringing it up, during the 2007 to 2011 period, the JLP government had abandoned the IMF program in a wanton act of fiscal irresponsibility, leaving Jamaica on the edge of a precipice and staring at disaster. When coming to office in 2012, Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller leveraged her many years of hard-earned political capital and laid it on the line. To lobby the international financial community to give Jamaica another chance. This was only possible because of the sacrifices of the Jamaican people who were willing to walk the walk because they trusted her not to sell them out. That is what saved our country from the ruin that the previous government had brought us to. We pulled the country out of the mire of fiscal irresponsibility. With Dr. Peter Phillips as Finance Minister and Portia Simpson Miller As Prime Minister, the PNP administration of 2012 to 2016 steadfastly prepared the ground in which the tree of fiscal responsibility began to grow in Jamaica. We got the country's public finances back on track. We transformed the tax system. We implemented other critical structural reforms along the journey. Along the journey of getting our national debt under control. And in 2016, the JLP inherited that tree with its roots firmly already in place and already bearing the fruit of fiscal stability. This is the foundation of the 12 years of economic stability that Jamaica has benefited from up to today. So, we taught you about fiscal responsibility on which the economic stability is built. In that period, I... In that period, I was tasked with responsibility for delivering the extensive legislation that was required to achieve that durable fiscal stability. A modernized revenue system and the other basic building blocks of economic stability. Yes, the same tree of economic stability you are now shading under. We nurtured its early growth. We made sure there could be no turning back. We led the way on fiscal responsibility. And you on the other side, then on this side, mocked us whilst we were planting and nurturing that tree of fiscal responsibility. All you do is pass IMF tests, you said over and over. Do you forget? So don't lecture us on fiscal responsibility and economic stability. No sanki, no sing so. We took the hard decisions and implemented them. You inherited a situation that we had fixed here in Jamaica. And you have spent 8 years leveraging that hard work that we put in and the fiscal responsibility that we left. And that is the truth. We on this side have no plans to cut down the tree of fiscal responsibility. It is a tree that I helped to plant and nurture with the work I did in that time. But we also, Madam Speaker, we also recognize that 2024 is not 2012, and the challenges and priorities are now different. Economic stability is not sufficient to meet the needs and expectations of the Jamaican people. The people need Jamaica to shift gear to something much better than what is going on now. The people want to see real change. Jamaica now needs a government that can take the country on the road to change. You say you're leveraging stability for all the people, but I must ask you, which people? Workers who are reeling from the high prices that keep going up? Farmers who are struggling in so many challenges? Civil servants, teachers, and doctors who feel disrespected? What are you saying and what people are feeling just don't match up? Who is really benefiting from the stability that you say you are leveraging? If you look at the 24-25 budget, the picture becomes more clear. Madam Speaker, in his opening budget speech last Tuesday, the minister announced a giveaway of $20,000 for employees and self-employed persons earning up to $3 million who are in the formal tax system. And he gave it the fancy name, reverse tax credit. He said that the objective is to incentivize on-time filing and paying statutory deductions. However, that objective is really questionable because to qualify for this, he says that you will have to become fully compliant for the 2023 tax year already gone by March 31, 2024. And that deadline is less than a fortnight away. Therefore, as a practical matter, it is most unlikely that anyone who is not already tax compliant will get the benefit. Furthermore, it is wishful thinking that a single payment of $20,000 would induce anyone who is now outside the tax system to take steps to bring themselves into it and start paying taxes. And it applies to persons below the threshold. The truth is that this so-called reverse tax credit smells like a $20,000 giveaway for political advantage as we get ever closer to the next general election. There's also another angle to it. The minister said that for an employee to be entitled to receive this reverse tax credit, his or her employer must have been fully compliant in making the statutory filings and payments for statutory deductions and employer contributions for 2023 by March 2024. Now I must ask the question, is this fair? How is it fair to an employee to deny him or her this little benefit in the event that the employer is not compliant with statutory filings and payments of deductions? Many businesses are now reeling from the increase in interest rates and are facing cash flow difficulties. So many of those employers may be behind in filings and payments of statutory deductions and employer contributions. The employee should not be blamed or penalized for that. Minister, an employer paying under $3 million to an employee, and the employee himself or herself should get this benefit, whatever the tax status of the employer. If you are on the system, you should get the benefit. In your estimate of $11.4 billion for this relief this year, you've assumed that 570,000 persons will be able to access it. So don't deny anyone the benefit on the grounds that their employer is delinquent. To do that would be simply unfair. Jamaica needs thoughtful governance. And that is why we are on the road to change. Madam Speaker, during the recent local government election campaign, the Prime Minister promised that the income tax threshold would be increased in what he said would be 1.5, 2.0. Last September, I had called for an increase of the threshold to $3 million, the purpose being to restore the real value, in real terms, of the $1.5 million that was announced back in 2016, and to provide some buffer for future inflation. The fact is that since 2016, accumulated inflation in Jamaica is over 46% since 2016, and an increase is required to restore the real value of the threshold that was last reset back in 2016. After the Prime Minister's grand election pronouncement of 1.5, 2.0, persons are understandably quite disappointed that the minister has announced an increase of the threshold to only 1.7 million. That's $200,000. What they expected to be 2.0 million ended up being 0.2 million. And that translates to a mere $4,166 per month in benefit in their take-home pay. And Madam Speaker, I am told, I didn't check it myself, but you can check it if you like, that $4,166 can't even buy a bucket of KFC for a family looking to share and have community with family and friends. Madam Speaker, if the minister had, as phase one of restoring the value of the 1.5, even increased the threshold to 2 million, that would give persons an additional $125,000 per year in their pockets, $10,400 per month in their take-home pay. And that would be a more meaningful benefit. And Madam Speaker, it could have been paid for by using the $11.4 billion that has been allocated to the one-time reverse tax credit. In getting to $3 million, As tax inflows continue to grow, the threshold can be adjusted again in the future, in phase two, and maybe even phase three, depending how long it takes. So, Madam Speaker, Jamaica needs caring governance, yes. And that is why we are on the road to change. I want to say something more about taxes. The minister likes to make a song and dance about no new taxes imposed since the last go-round of $30 billion in new taxes, which was imposed in the first 2 years of the JLP government elected in 2016 to pay for the 1.5. Then the promise had been at the time that it would pay for itself, but that wasn't so. They had to impose $30+ billion of taxes to pay for it. However, it is important to recognize that the taxes being collected from the Jamaican people have increased dramatically under this government. Dramatically. Have a look at that table. And you will see, in fiscal year 2015-16, which was the last year of the last PNP administration, the tax collected was $411.8 billion, which was 24% of GDP. The above table, this table, shows how much more tax. This table shows how much more tax is being collected under the current JLP administration. Tax collected now has moved from 24% of GDP to 28% of GDP. A much bigger carving of the national pie is now being paid by the Jamaican people in tax under the JLP. Jamaicans are taxed much more under this JLP government. That's just a fact. And if you look over the 4 years, the four fiscal years, 21-22 through 24-25, Madam Speaker, and I want you to listen to this, tax collections have increased by $409 billion. That's the increase in taxes over 4 years. $419 billion of additional taxes have been collected from the Jamaican people over the last 4 years.
The member's time for speaking has expired.
That's why I get caught out.
Madam Speaker,
members,
Madam Speaker, I
members.
Madam Speaker, I now ask that the standing orders be suspended to enable the member to continue his speech to its conclusion.
Question is that the member be allowed to continue his speech to conclusion. Those in favor?
Aye.
Those against, the ayes have it.
So, Madam Speaker, thank you for that. Thank you, colleagues. As I was saying, over the last 4 years, $419 billion of additional taxes have been taken from the Jamaican people. That is an increase of 66%, which is way more, in fact, more than double the accumulated inflation over those 4 years. Over those 4 years, 31% was the accumulated inflation. The tax has gone up by 66%, tax collected. And looking at tax collection on a per capita basis, in other words, looking at tax collection from the perspective of each Jamaican, since this JLP government came to office, they have more than doubled the annual tax take from every man, woman, and child in Jamaica, increasing it by a massive $190,000 per person. And it now totals $342,000 per person at the time of this current budget. They've more than doubled the taxes they're taking from the people. So much for this no new taxes, Sankey. It is irrelevant. No new tax types, but much, much more taxes. 28% of GDP in taxes relative to 24 back in 2015-16. And as the recent election shows, who feels it knows it. Madam Speaker, Jamaica really needs honest governance. And that is why we are on the road to change. Madam Speaker, the minister says he's going to take away the protection that our farmers have enjoyed by removing GCT from the importation of raw produce. He says that Jamaica is on the cusp of being blacklisted by the World Trade Organization, the WTO, if we continue to protect our farmers. Well, based on our research, the WTO does not blacklist or unilaterally punish member states for non-compliance. Instead, an aggrieved member state must first enter into consultations with a non-compliant member state to seek changes on the particular measure that they are complaining of, or to win concessions before requesting the establishment of a panel to settle the dispute. The panel will thereafter issue a report, which can subsequently be appealed before the WTO's appellate body. The minister really therefore needs to state whose bidding he's doing by removing this GCT that was in place to protect our farmers. In recent years, the tensions in US-China relations, the Russia-EU sanctions resulting from the war in Ukraine and so on, have adversely affected the workings of the WTO. For some time now, the WTO has not had a functioning dispute settlement mechanism since the US decided not to appoint members to the appellate body. And furthermore, the recently concluded MC13 meeting of trade ministers in Abu Dhabi, a number of critical issues were left unresolved. Reforms in the dispute settlement mechanism and so on, including subsidies in agriculture and fisheries by developed nations, and other long outstanding issues for the benefit of small and vulnerable economies like Jamaica. In this context, we must question why the minister finds it necessary to proceed down this path instead of entering into negotiations with whichever party is agreed, we don't know who it is, as provided for under the WTO rules. The minister was also vague on the scope of this announced measure. What exactly are the imported raw food items for which GCT will be removed? I note that under the GCT Act, Third Schedule, Part 1, Paragraph 6, the category of raw foodstuff is extremely wide and specifically includes fresh fruit, vegetables, ground provisions, legumes, onions, garlic, meat, which is a very wide category, poultry, and fish. The removal of this protection leaves our farmers very exposed to unfair competition from importers who have little risk. We know that the rich countries of the world, North America and Europe, provide massive subsidies to their agricultural sectors, distorting fair competition and giving food imports from those countries an advantage over our producers here in Jamaica. Over the past 15 years, food imports into Jamaica have seen a steady increase, reaching over $1.4 billion in 2022, according to Statin. In contrast, our agricultural exports lagged far behind at a mere $273 million in that year. And this is a trend, and it underscores the vulnerability of local food production. Local farmers already contend with high overhead costs, including GCT and various inputs that they use, farm supplies, which producers in other countries do not face. Jamaican farmers have other disadvantages, including their small scale, relatively speaking, reliance on rainfall rather than irrigation systems for many farmers, and limited access to mechanization and financial resources. In 2022, loans allocated to farming operations amounted to a mere $146.3 million. That's all. The removal of GCT on imported foodstuff will worsen this imbalance between locally produced and imported foods. It is likely to adversely impact the sector. and the livelihood of farmers while undermining rural communities who are the breadbasket of our country. Only last year, we saw how onion farmers in St. Thomas were hurt badly when import permits were granted to importers and flooded the market with foreign onions, leaving our farmers with produce that they could not sell last year. In removing the GCT on the imports of produce, nothing has been put in place to protect our farmers from the wave of imports of produce that will now come into the market without paying GCT. And there's a common theme here, Mr. Speaker. When I was in St. Elizabeth recently, the fishermen were complaining bitterly that they cannot sell their lobster because big players are supplying the market at low prices and squeezing them out. Their MP is the Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries, yet they are suffering. The government is letting them down badly, and it's a crying shame. Mr. Speaker, there's also the critical necessity for transparency in the allocation of these permits for imported foodstuff to ensure that there's proper consideration for local production capacity and to eliminate the possibility for nepotism, cronyism, and other forms of corruption. And we all hear who the major importers are. Jamaica Agricultural Society, the JAS, was apparently not consulted before this measure was announced by the minister, which in itself is an egregious example of arrogant and uncaring governance. We have to ask, who benefits from this? Certainly not the farmers. So who? We have consulted with the farming community, and a raft of measures have been developed that can mitigate against what could turn out to be a very serious and prejudicial action if the farmers of Jamaica are to get a fair deal. The ideas have been proposed simultaneously to remove GCT from farm input supplies, including essential planting materials like seeds and farm tools and equipment to incentivize local producers and strengthen their sustainability. We could remove GCT from local food products, such as table eggs, to make them affordable and stimulate demand and push local production. We must enhance transparency, as I've said, in food imports. We can make the grant of import permits subject to parliamentary scrutiny and approval, requiring that import permits must be allocated on an equitable and transparent process, such as a public auction. And Madam Speaker, or Mr. Speaker, until protective measures like these are put in place and are working effectively, replace the GCT on import foodstuff with a stamp duty on imported foodstuffs to level the playing field between imported and locally produced food. And we need to discourage over-reliance on food imports. It takes a little care to find solutions, some empathy, and some will. Jamaica needs open, prudent governance. And that is why we are on the road to change. Mr. Speaker, the Minister announced various tax breaks for the coming fiscal year, totaling $25.12 billion. Many no doubt expect that these tax breaks will be an annual cost to the budget going forward. However, the minister has not provided the country with any clear and sustainable plan to finance these tax breaks in future years. To the contrary, we were told by him last Tuesday that this $25.12 billion, the annual cost of these measures, is to be entirely paid for in the coming fiscal year by a one-off securitization of some receivables. He has not said what those receivables are. And when I asked him about this after his speech, his response to me was, the information is market sensitive. Mr. Speaker, this is totally unacceptable. The country must be told exactly how these tax breaks are to be financed. In the coming fiscal year and thereafter, the public may well be asking, what is a securitization of receivables? Simply put, it is a transaction where the government raises money now by selling sources of revenue that will be earned in the future. This means that a future government will not have access to those sources of revenue because they will have been sold now. And this government will have sold them off to fund its budget this year, leaving the cupboard dry. So who is benefiting from this? We want to know. Minister, the current March 15th deadline for filing income taxes and other returns is pretty rough on everyone who has to file their taxes. Getting the past year's accounts audited and then preparing the tax returns all by the 15th March is really too much of a crunch. An April deadline would ease pressure significantly, and it's time for change. Many other countries have later deadlines, and it helps with their budgeting and their financial planning. So why not take a leaf out of their book? It would give taxpayers who file more time to get their taxes right and would improve the accuracy of their tax filings. It also improves compliance by allowing a more reasonable deadline. It would be a step towards a stronger and more stable economy. Mr. Speaker, the minister was on board with this idea back in 2021-2022, but we're now in 2024-25, and he has become very silent about it since then. I think it's high time that we see some action on this, Minister, and I hope that you will see your way to doing it. Mr. Speaker, on several occasions, including in my budget presentations in 2021, in 2022, and in 2023, I call for the total removal of the requirement for guarantors to access a student loan. The data I had seen when I was chairman of the Public Accounts Committee showed that the collection from these guarantors was minimal in the scheme of things, and there was evidence to show that the requirement to provide guarantors made student loans inaccessible to many students, in particular students from low-income families. That is why I repeatedly called for the requirement of guarantors to be abolished overall. I'm therefore happy that the minister has finally heeded that call and removed the requirement of guarantors of student loans for everyone. Mr. Speaker, it is yet another example of how good things happen when this government listens to the opposition. And indeed, it shows how much better things will be when the opposition becomes the government. Reminds me of my call in last year's budget, a year ago, for an increase to US$150 in the duty-free allowance for online shoppers, for which a minister later adopted in part when he announced the increase to $100 US at the JLP conference in November. Mr. Speaker, Jamaica needs change in the current approach to economic development, and that is where I'm going to move to now. In the just completed local government elections, the Prime Minister argued that the people must not vote with their emotions. He said they should pay attention to all the positive macroeconomic indicators that mean things are good. He said they should hold on and stay the course because Jamaica will soon take off. But the people showed with their votes that they are not convinced. They are not convinced because the economic model of this government benefits too few people. Indeed, the people cried out with their ballots that a better way exists and that better must come. Under the current socio-economic model being pursued by this government, inequality of wealth and income will remain entrenched in Jamaican society. Jamaica is 99th in the countries of the world in terms of commitments to reduce inequality, according to Oxfam. In the 2022 World Inequality Index, the wealth gap in Jamaica was shown to be as wide as in Haiti. In Jamaica, the top 1% control 20% of national wealth, and the top 10% control 50% of national wealth. The Jamaica Survey of Living Conditions 2021, which is the most current available to us, says that there has been an upward movement in both poverty and inequality under the JLP government. And it says, and I'll quote, the prevalence of poverty increased to 16.7% from 11% in 2019. And that inequality increased with the Gini coefficient, and that is the standard measurement of inequality, at 0.3991, up from 0.3671 in 2019. So I wonder, where in this economic performance has there been any leveraging for the people?
None.
With inflation running hot and the cost of living increasing by 30% since then, the situation, no doubt, the situation remains dire now. In short, the people are feel it the way your government are deal with it. The minister announced that GDP per capita in Jamaica is now $7,000. He didn't mention that GDP per capita data doesn't show inequality. He didn't mention that poverty is 4 times the rate of unemployment in Jamaica. He didn't mention that Trinidad and Tobago, Barbados, and Guyana are all at around $20,000 per capita compared to Jamaica's $7,000. For Jamaica to move our GDP from $7,000 where it is now to $20,000 over the next 15 years would require an annual real GDP growth of at least 7% per year. I'm going to repeat that. For Jamaica to get our national GDP per capita from 7,000 US, where it is now, to 20,000, which is where Trinidad, Barbados, and Guyana are, over 15 years, it's going to require an annual real GDP growth rate of at least 7% per annum. Until we start to put things in place to achieve that level of inclusive, sustainable growth, the talk of prosperity is a deception and an illusion. Mr. Speaker, there is a concept called economic complexity, which measures the extent to which knowledge drives high value-added economic activity in a country. It's a strong indicator of a country's capacity to achieve higher levels of economic growth. It measures essentially the sophistication of the economy and the linkages within it, using knowledge to drive economic output. There's a chart. I don't know if it can be brought up. There it is. Thank you. Now, that chart shows a comparison of 3 countries, and it's taken from the Harvard Economic Complexity Ranking. And it compares economic complexity trends in Jamaica, in the Dominican Republic, and in Costa Rica. And if you look at it, Jamaica is at the bottom on the right. And Jamaica's descent between 2010 and 2021 is indicative of our failure to build a model of socioeconomic development that can transition us from a raw materials and raw services economy to one of a different level of sophistication, producing high value added goods and services. Mr. Speaker, under the current model being pursued by this government, inequality of wealth and income will remain entrenched in Jamaican society for years to come. We must transition Jamaica from a low-wage, low-tech, low-growth economy to one that achieves high levels of inclusive, sustainable growth that can meet the needs and aspirations of our people. This is a clear metric telling us that change is not only required but urgent.
That's right.
We on this side are not deceived. We are on the ground where the people are feeling the pressure.
Yes.
Even though this government likes to tell the people to take responsibility for their actions, it is not very good at taking its own advice. Yes. Though the world has moved on, they are still stuck in this trickle-down neoliberal economics, where support is given at the top of the economy and people must wait for prosperity to trickle down to them. That model depends on low wages. That model thrives on low levels of education. It pushes people into things like scamming. It pushes people into hustling for a living. It causes hard-working and unemployed people alike to rely on remittances from their family abroad. And it forces people to migrate. If we are exporting our skills, what are we left with? It depends on people being deceived. But we are not deceived, and we are not the deceivers. Mr. Speaker, it is now quite clear that there's nothing in the minister's budget presentation that suggests that this government has a coherent strategy for achieving a turnaround of that chart. As I have said, wild campaign promises like converting Clarkstown into a city are mere pie-in-the-sky ideas masquerading as a vision of national development. I will now present some elements of our comprehensive holistic plan for sustainable, inclusive development of Jamaica and our people. Some of the plans for the next Jamaican government that we will form on the road to change. Mr. Speaker, since I last addressed this Honourable House in a budget debate, we have been progressively developing our plans for Jamaica, and they are grounded in our core beliefs of social justice, equality of opportunity and access, and good governance. Last year, in my contribution to this debate, I spoke about some of the prevailing challenges that were at the forefront of the minds of the Jamaican people: constitutional reform and the need for government with integrity were areas that I emphasized. We call upon the government to repair the breach with regard to the expectations of Jamaicans concerning land, education, security for our people, social transformation, health, energy, and food security. We remain true to those core tenets of national development strategy. I was both tactical and practical when I named our new shadow cabinet. I designed a governance structure that is fit for purpose, creating four new policy clusters, bringing a solutions-oriented approach to the changes that we need to see in this nation. Then, in preparation for the local government elections, we laid out our agenda for change at the community, divisional, and municipal level. The people of Jamaica responded positively to change and the change agenda on the 26th of February. That plan, as I've said, is now going to be put in action, and we're putting in place a monitoring and evaluation mechanism to drive that change. Right, Natalie? That's right. At the national level, our policies and programs must be consistent with the core values of our party: social justice, inclusion, transparency, and, as I've said, a commitment to greater equality. Yes. We have crafted a raft of practical measures and a national change approach, and it emphasizes communication, care, and culturally sensitive implementation, honesty and openness, accessibility and inclusiveness, new policy approaches, good governance, and engaging and empowering all our people. Change. Today I'm going to share a selection of some of those measures, and they stand on two pillars: the economic model of the next PNP government and our grounding in and commitment to good governance. The time has come for us to center the needs of the people in a transformational economic model. The time has come for broadening the wealth and ownership base of the society to tackle the chronic scourge of inequality. We must do what is required for high levels of inclusive, sustainable growth to meet the needs and aspirations of our people. The emphasis on inclusive and sustainable growth is important, The fruits of economic expansion must be equitably shared across the society. And the investments must be compatible with our natural assets to preserve our environment for the benefit of future generations. Jamaicans are not interested in economic stability that only trickles down into low growth and diminishing prospects. They want to be able to afford an education, get a decent job, or build a thriving business, and own a home. And that's why we must transition Jamaica from a low-wage, low-tech, low-growth economy. We have to transition from an excessive dependence on remittances to earnings from high-valued exports of goods and services. We must give persons, people, alternative to unlawful economic activities. Indeed, the structure of our economy must nurture public safety rather than criminality. And everyone must understand that they have a role to play in making a Jamaica that is a nice place to live. This means people must pay their fair share of taxes, and the government must be accountable to the people because it is spending the people's money. Spending must prioritize access to basic needs, giving people an opportunity for entrepreneurialism to thrive, giving people an education from which they can create new ideas and opportunities, and nurture our indigenous talents. The type of transformation that Jamaica needs will require investment in its people and in possibilities for the people. Mr. Speaker, the major impediments to Jamaica achieving high-level education system and a training system that is not fit for purpose, which contributes both of those to Jamaica's low national productivity. High levels of violent crime, high electricity costs that undermine the competitiveness of our economy, and insufficient economic diversification that would increase our resilience to the growing threats from climate-related and other external shocks. Mr. Speaker, none of these challenges can be successfully tackled if we do not address the prevailing failures of governance in the country. Until the systems of governance are accountable, transparent, and participatory, dog nyam we suffer. Mr. Speaker, I believe that all of us as Jamaicans are responsible for creating the Jamaica we want to see and establishing a liberty of the Jamaicans we want to be. That is why our focus is social cohesion and empowerment. This portfolio cluster will focus on transformation, productivity, and access by addressing the ways in which health and wellness, social transformation, social protection, gender, young people, and civil society, persons with disabilities and other marginalized groups will not only be engaged, but energized and empowered. Human capital development is highest on our list. This is what we mean when we say we put the people first. It is what we say when we believe in people power. And we balance the books while balancing people's lives. Mr. Speaker, the next PNP government is committed to implementing measures to ensure that Jamaica's human capital has the capacities and skills to participate competitively in a high value added economic environment, which can support the required investments that build that environment and deliver high levels of inclusive, sustainable growth. The crisis in education and training must be tackled and overcome if this is to be achieved. We see education in a holistic way. The education system should be socializing our people towards the kind of society we want to live in. 100% literacy and numeracy must be the target for national transformation. And there is food insecurity in Jamaica, so we cannot avoid dealing with children's nutrition. The system must invest in teachers, as well as infrastructure and technology, and in supporting services for parenting. We feel no shame about the fact that the majority of our students speak Jamaican, the Jamaican language first, and we think it should be central to how they learn to speak English and other subjects. As Professor Don Robotham recently put it, we must meet our children where they are and teach English as a foreign language it is to many of them. Though we must prioritize the early childhood and primary school system to raise standards there, especially in basic literacy and numeracy, we also believe in tertiary education. And we also believe that education must be lifelong to address gaps and reskilling at the adult levels. In the areas of education and training, these are some of our proposals. We will make investments in teacher training and in teacher compensation, in infrastructure and technology, and in support services for parenting. We will expand and improve the school feeding program to ensure adequate and proper nutrition. To ensure adequate and proper nutrition and to encourage school attendance. We will prioritize the early childhood and primary school system to raise standards, eliminate the major existing literacy and numeracy deficits, because our goal is for Jamaica to have the best early childhood and primary school system in the hemisphere. We will put emphasis on STEAM education across the education system. We are not just going to focus on a few institutions when the system as a whole is deficient in STEAM education. And we will provide one full scholarship for the first child per family for a university degree. And we will remove taxes from laptops and tablets for students. And ensure that every teacher has a laptop. And for our teachers, we'll provide them with student debt. For our teachers, we will provide them with student debt reductions and motor vehicle concessions, which increase with their years of service in the system. We will provide teachers with enhanced access to National Housing Trust loans and priority in housing allocations in NHT finance schemes. We will provide teachers with a package deal to be negotiated by government for free internet access as a tool of trade. And for young people, we will incentivize our youth to invest in their education by capping their monthly student loan payments at a reasonable percentage of their actual income. So that in times when the borrower, the student or former student is not working, those payments are deferred and tagged to the back end of their loan without them incurring extra interest or penalties. We will reinvigorate and repurpose HART to be a major player in a wider project to prepare our workforce for the current and emerging employment opportunities of the 21st century, including by building training partnerships with the private sector. Mr. Speaker, our nation's training capacity must be as relevant and fit for purpose as possible in a rapidly evolving economy that we must build. We will create a series of workforce development training partnerships with the private sector. And the objective is to develop a competitively market-driven approach to training our workforce. This market-driven approach leverages the training capacity of all of the public sector and private tertiary education and training institutions. The objective is to increase the national capacity to deliver a transformational impact to the economy through an upskilled workforce in the shortest possible time. We will welcome the participation of trade unions and employer associations in these partnerships. We need all hands on deck to transition our economy to high value-added goods and services. Mr. Speaker, HART will support private sector-led investments in training by matching grants of up to 50% of the cost of any employer-identified third-party delivered training program that improves the performance or well-being of the employer's staff. And this approval would be automatic, up to an amount equal to 90% of that employer's and employee's annual contributions to HART. And if the need is larger, then it can be approved on the basis of some clear, established, and transparent priorities. We will provide incentives to encourage employers to establish internship programs that build the needs of their businesses and industry with course offerings of tertiary and skills training institutions. We will utilize school infrastructure, which is often, when outside of school hours, insufficiently used. We'll use school infrastructure to enhance training, both to school children and surrounding communities. We will entrench civics education as a core subject in the national curriculum. We will entrench it to equip our students for actual and productive citizenship with an understanding of the Constitution, an understanding of their rights, their responsibilities as citizens, and social skills based on wholesome values and attitudes. Mr. Speaker, we will build the teachings of the right excellent Marcus Mosiah Garvey into the school curriculum. At all levels, on an age-appropriate basis, to encourage self-belief, personal responsibility, and self-actualization in our nation's youth. We will establish a National Reserve Research and Development Council, bringing all relevant institutions together from within the state, academia, the private sector, trade unions, to develop and monitor and evaluate a national R&D strategy. And we will provide an accelerated write-off for taxes of expenditure on research and development to encourage greater private investment in innovation that ties agriculture to manufacturing, science, technology, and advances the labor force. Mr. Speaker, human capital development is directly linked to citizen security. It is about developing an aware, thoughtful, and thinking society that can access a wide range of opportunities locally and indeed globally, with not only the skills but also the values and attitudes that promote national development. Mr. Speaker, the very high levels of violent crime in our country continue to demoralize our nation. It discourages investment. It increases the public cost of medical care, and it reduces our capacity to achieve high levels of inclusive, sustainable economic growth. I have emphasized that we see education and training as a means to reduce the levels of violence and crime in our society. And I'm making the broader point that to make Jamaica a safe country in which to live, work, raise families, and do business, a different approach must be taken to national security. Or as we have started to call it, to citizen security, coupled with a concerted thrust for social transformation. We prefer to think about citizen security because it forces us to think of people's needs. Yes. Our people deserve respect. It shows us, for instance, that road safety is a citizen security issue. Yes. If roads are potholed and motorists are forced to swerve as a result, all people using the roads are at risk, so it affects security. If streetlights don't work, it compromises women's, in particular, sense of security. And if militarization is the way forward, we will see more and more videos of mass policemen with long guns hauling and intimidating citizens. Yeah. And that's not the Jamaica we want. No. We cannot build a future and a nation by locking down underserved communities. Yeah. The better way is to make Jamaica safe for all by a progressive approach to citizen security. Yeah. And I'm going to share with you some of our proposals for making Jamaica a safe society for us all. We will revitalize the Peace Management Initiative. Through the Peace Management Initiative, we want to build a network in all of the violence-prone communities across the country, rolling out restorative justice, mediation, and other conflict resolution techniques at the community level. We will train and empower at least 500 violence interrupters across Jamaica. We'll partner with the private sector and other stakeholders to expand Project STAR, which they have initiated, and make it into a truly national program, including things like access to training, mentorship, remedial education, and job placements for youth at risk. We will enact legislation that targets known vicious purveyors of criminal violence across Jamaica and brings them to justice, including through a court-supervised process of pre-charge detention that targets persons on whom there's credible intelligence to facilitate building viable cases that can result in a successful prosecution. Due process is critical here, and that is why it must be a court-supervised process. And, Mr. Speaker, we will bring much greater focus on reforming the prison system to reduce the high level of recidivism. In other words, people who offend are imprisoned. When they're released, they offend again and come back into prison. That is recidivism. We need to reduce the high level of recidivism, which is very high in Jamaica, some 40%, I believe, by rehabilitating offenders to become productive citizens rather than re-offenders. When they return to society, every Jamaican has an interest in a prison system that rehabilitates prisoners and makes them productive citizens. We're fooling ourselves if we think that we can just ignore that, let the prisons run in the way they currently run, and solve our national security problem. We will provide the police force with the vehicles, equipment, and training that they need to efficiently respond and investigate and prosecute offenders. We will build out the Jamaica Eye system of cameras to enhance citizen security and ensure greater accountability for criminal behavior. It is an important part of making Jamaica safe. And we will provide mental health support, including adequate rest to our law enforcement officers to help them cope with the difficulties of their line of work here in Jamaica. And we will partner with non-governmental organizations to support well-designed and sustainable community-based interventions that focus on anger management, parenting skills, conflict resolution, and overall civility, and substantially increase the number of social workers to take on these critical tasks and build social cohesion within communities. This is a balanced approach to dealing with citizen security, and it is essential. Without it, we are not going to get the results that we need. Mr. Speaker, we recognize that crime and other socially negative behaviors in Jamaica emerge from the imbalanced structure of our society. This is why we prioritize social justice and workers' rights as an essential part of the role of government. As a society with a history of oppression of our people, we must be ever mindful of the need to build healthy employment relations. That includes how government treats the civil service. Government must set the example for how all other employers treat workers. And at a most basic level, we will approach all negotiations with the public sector workers with respect, openness, and a spirit of partnership. The government has been boasting about low unemployment, but many of these jobs are below the International Labour Organization standards for decent work. Many young people are frustrated and are no longer looking for a job. Low unemployment exists alongside high underemployment, with hundreds of thousands of Jamaicans of working age staying outside the workforce, unwilling to work for wages that cannot sustain them with a decent quality of life. We see workers across the economy working for years under fixed-term contracts, and the government will not address this structural inequity affecting the labor market. We have a labor market reform report which focuses on productivity improvements, and it has been left in file 13. We need to advance from a minimum wage system to a livable wage system. Tied to increase productivity to be sustainable. The next PNP government will introduce structural reforms that balance the interests of workers and employers to bring about productivity, equity, and decent work. Our government will seek to ensure that the workers of Jamaica are respected and their rights are protected. And I'm going to share some of our proposals with you. As I've said, we will approach all negotiations with the public sector workers and their representatives with respect, openness, and a spirit of partnership. We will enact comprehensive legislation to eliminate abusive contractual arrangements which circumvent employment rights right across the economy. The government is going through a slow and incremental process of eliminating this practice from the public sector. And it was thrust on the government by the ruling of the court, which affected security guards. But that is incrementalism and is not enough. Many, many workers outside of the government service, the public sector, are affected by this problem. We will ensure equal treatment of all workers, regardless of the legal form of their contracts. We will pursue the establishment of joint industrial councils in those industries where there are high levels of employment, but there's no common standard for working conditions and there's no union representation. The security guard industry, the tourism industry, the global services BPO, those industries are cases in point where a joint industrial council would really move things forward. We'll review the incentives legislation for employee share ownership plans to make it user-friendly and easy to comply with and administer, followed by a promotional exercise to encourage Jamaican firms to establish employee share ownership plans, which align employer and employee interests and create wealth for their workers at all levels, from the bearer right up to the CEO. And I've had personal experience that the consistent empowerment and enrichment that workers can benefit from through employee share ownership plans. We will establish a commission to examine the dire situation now faced by communities in the former sugar areas, yes, and to develop a comprehensive plan for the economic revitalization of those areas. And we've seen in the sugar belts across the country where sugar has atrophied with nothing to replace it. And what has in fact replaced it is the scamming and other activities and high levels of violent crime. We need to do something about that. And we will put in place proper and dignified relocation arrangements for the families of former sugar workers. We have seen too many cases where they're not being treated fairly, in Innswood and so on, where they're being moved off the land without any proper arrangements being made to house them. These priority areas will be built out using social transformation and social protection interventions, techniques, and measures linked into health and wellness strategies. They will be informed by gender considerations and directly address the needs of persons with disabilities, with inclusion being a guiding principle. Social cohesion and empowerment drive sustainable economic development. Productivity. Productivity thrives where people feel safe, secure, and motivated. Productivity, in turn, drives diversification and growth, building our existing productive sectors and enabling new ones to emerge in an inclusive and sustainable growth path for Jamaica. That's right. Mr. Speaker, We need a sound approach to economic management if we are to achieve sustainable economic development. It requires continuing along the fiscal responsibility path that we have established jointly over the years, and it has to be maintained by bipartisan support. And we are committed to ensuring that the gains that Jamaica has made in stabilizing its public finances are permanently kept for future generations. I spoke to this earlier, and our shadow spokesman of finance dealt with it extensively in his budget presentation last Thursday. Sustainable economic development will require transitioning Jamaica, as I've said, to one where high-value goods and services are delivered to domestic and export markets. And I want to share some practical steps that can be taken in that direction, beginning with food security. Mr. Speaker, the government is not serious about agriculture and food security, and it is reflected in the estimates of expenditure that were tabled. Yeah. Critical areas are being neglected. Farm roads expenditure has been reduced. Extension services, which provide guidance to farmers, is flat. Technical support is being decreased. And most importantly, research and development only gets a 2.7% increase, which is way below inflation. The allocation for irrigation, which supports the National Irrigation Commission, is also flat, while Essex Valley and Southern Plains projects are coming to an end, having undergone numerous extensions. Examples of areas for growth in agriculture include supporting research and activities like extracting oil. Extracting oils and flavors, developing value-added products from our agricultural produce, and capturing economic potential from waste from harvesting. The quality of our produce is world-renowned, and it's part of our overall creative product in the country. We're also sorely disappointed by the direction that the medicinal and therapeutic ganja industry has been taken since the PNP government decriminalized its use in 2015 and created a platform for a new lawful industry to emerge. Our cannabis sector must be developed in a way that is far more inclusive for small farmers. Now find themselves marginalized and excluded. That was never the philosophy when we did this. And I'm very disappointed by the way it's played out. We're going to have to give it some special attention when we form government. The next PNP government will be focused on genuinely increasing exports, strengthening food security in Jamaica, expanding irrigation and research capabilities in the agricultural sector. And we're going to brand this the SMART program. Sustainable management of agriculture through research and technology. Yeah. SMART. Yeah. With the limited land space available in Jamaica and a growing population that we need to feed, we must find the right synergies between increased food production and sustaining the natural environment. Our housing programs will not compromise the most fertile and irrigated lands, as this government has done at Bernard Lodge. There are some proposals under the SMART program that I want to mention. We will manage the sector through increased training of our youth, with a focus on agricultural training institutions such as 4-H clubs and the extension services offered through RADA. We will increase the productivity of our farmers through introduction of improved climate-smart farming systems and technology to drive farming operations. We'll expand and repair the farm road network to enable our farmers to access their farms and transport their produce to market. We'll engage our major private sector players in the poultry and agriculture processing and milk and livestock production to create the enabling environment that they require so they can expand their already significant contribution to the economy. We'll partner with the UWI and other technical institutions to engage in research that will boost productivity. The College of Agricultural Science and Education, CASE, must be given the financial resources to do the necessary research that will assist our farmers to produce at a consistently high quality. And in fact, the next PNP administration intends to upgrade CASE to a university to enhance to enhance the focused institutional support required for a thrust to greater food security in the country. We will boost our own research facilities at Bodles and Orange River and Montpelier to provide innovations that our farmers require to grow the sector. We will make the best planting stock, animal genetics and farming systems in animal husbandry and agronomy available to our farmers. We'll increase the use of drones, RFID technology, hydroponic farming systems, solar-operated irrigation pumps, and in-field monitoring of soil fertility to boost our production and increase productivity. And we will strengthen the laws to protect our farmers from agricultural theft, bringing those offences under the Proceeds of Crime Act regime so that the profits can be taken away from criminals who reap what our farmers sow. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, our goal is for agriculture and agro-industries to contribute at least 10 to 12% of Jamaica's GDP, transforming rural development, providing sustainable employment across the country, and guaranteeing our nation's food security. This is why we are adamant that our concerns regarding the removal of GCT from imported foods be immediately reviewed, reconsidered, and the initiatives that we proposed earlier be put into action. Mr. Speaker, I now turn to a number of emerging industries and some of our plans for their development. Like our spokesperson on finance explained, energy, broadband, and internet access are all central considerations for advancing inclusive and sustainable economic growth. Jamaica's fixed broadband population penetration of 15% in 2022 ranks Jamaica at the lower end of internet penetration and adoption when compared to other countries in the Caribbean. Our fixed broadband subscription is lower than the Cayman, Trinidad, and Grenada. We will prioritize investments and initiatives to bridge the digital divide. To ensure that all Jamaican citizens have access to affordable and reliable internet services. This will require investment in building a robust digital infrastructure and expanding access to high-speed internet connectivity, a process which has already started and which needs to be accelerated. By achieving digital connectivity right across the country, Jamaica can create a level playing field for persons to access online education, remote work opportunities, and digital services, thereby enabling them to participate fully in an increasingly digital economy. We also intend to expand partnerships with telecoms companies to deploy broadband networks in underserved areas, providing incentives to encourage adoption of digital technologies in low-income households. Mr. Speaker, the emergence of artificial intelligence, AI, as a new frontier of technological advancement is already having a massive global impact on commerce and indeed life in general. And this is only going to intensify in years to come. We're really at the very beginning of the effects of AI on our lives. Jamaica therefore needs to prepare itself for the positive and negative effects of AI technology so we can benefit from its massive potential for greater efficiency and competitiveness, and mitigate the serious risks of misrepresentation and fraud that come with AI. Okay. The next PMP administration will develop and introduce an AI-related curriculum and digital literacy programs from primary school through to tertiary education. By equipping students with foundational skills in coding, data analysis, and critical thinking, we will cultivate a new generation of AI-savvy individuals who are well-prepared for the jobs of the future. We have to embrace the present in a way that will prepare our people for the future. We will also introduce adult education and skills training programs to upskill and reskill the existing workforce so that Jamaican citizens aren't left behind as automation and AI technologies reshape the labor market. And the issue of internet penetration is also tied to the distribution of digital technology. Yes. Yes. It impacts growth of the cluster of emerging industries that we have identified for priority attention. Global logistics, cultural creative industries, sports, our environmental and ecological heritage, yes, and community tourism. These are industries that we think have tremendous potential. As with agriculture, this government has not demonstrated its seriousness about the development of cultural and creative industries or sports. The absence of a development plan for culture and the creative industries after 8 years and the barely touched national sports policy that we left behind bear witness to this. Mr. Speaker, the One Love phenomenon, now blowing like a natural mystic across the globe, shows us what cultural and creative practitioners have been telling us for years. Nurturing and growing the cultural and creative industries, sports, and their diverse ecosystems is extremely important for economic development and for cultural identity in Jamaica. This requires the funding and deliberate effort to drive these industries, which are two of the fastest growing areas of economic activity in the world. In this year's budget, $234 million is allocated to the Jamaican Screen Development Initiative, and we endorse that. The government has identified two entertainment spaces. They say they've identified them. One of them has been identified long ago, and one of them was used for entertainment from long ago. But it's a good start after many years of inaction. We commit that when we are in government, we'll prioritize the participatory development of a master plan comprising a comprehensive policy and legislative framework to support and incentivize the cultural and creative industries and sports. The plan will address investment and finance, education and training, infrastructure development for cultural and creative persons, practitioners, and also sports practitioners. Existing infrastructure for the cultural and creative industries and sports are falling apart island-wide. The Trelawney Sports Center, Independence Park, Catherine Hall, Sabina Park, the Little Theater, Ward Theater, Vale Royal, and other existing and potential heritage sites are disintegrating from neglect. How come? Change is sorely needed. Mr. Speaker, in the area of tourism, we are committed to trying to broaden the benefits flowing to our people from the massive investments that have taken place in tourism. Indeed, we're spending $4 billion advertising sun, sea, and sand. And we think that the government should direct some of these resources to developing and promoting community tourism, cultural industries, sports, ecotourism, and craft. For example, a round-robin series of reggae arts and cultural festivals across the island at various dates throughout the year would directly boost community incomes as part of our integrated plan. And it can be done through the municipal corporations to encourage community development. In other words, community tourism for community development. And that type of community tourism activity would produce revenue for the local authorities and help them to deliver services at a higher level to their communities. And this approach promotes greater economic inclusion.
That's it.
It's a glimpse of what holistic implementation across these important emerging sectors could look like, promoting sustainable economic development. While the existing enclave model of tourism generates wealth for that sector, it is not sufficiently impacting the communities in proximity to the enclaves. Though we hear the boasts of record tourism arrivals, we hear very little on why it seems not to elevate communities across Jamaica. And Mr. Speaker, at this point, I want to say one commitment that I have, which is in keeping with our seriousness about culture and the creative industries. When we form the next government, I commit to conferring the Order of National Hero on the Honorable Robert Nesta Marley. most distinguished nature in advancing Jamaican culture and his global impact as a liberating, inspirational force for oppressed people across the world. I say, time come to recognize the Gang as a true national hero and confer that honor on him accordingly. Mr. Speaker, I now turn to measures to make real our commitment to the development of infrastructure and human amenities. The vexed issue of energy costs in Jamaica needs to be addressed. They are way too high, and they are another structural impediment to economic transformation. We have some proposals to ensure a viable and sustainable electricity system and to bring down electricity costs to consumers and businesses. We'll undertake a massive regularization support drive for electricity connections, including a subsidy to help families meet the costs of rewiring, inspection, and certification. And we will provide these families with solar panels to help them manage their energy costs going forward and build climate sustainability. We'll roll out a national energy efficiency, natural lighting, and passive cooling program financed by local, regional, and international development banks and private risk capital. The objective here is to achieve an average 50% reduction in residential energy consumption and costs with a very short payback of a few years. We'll prioritize achieving our renewable energy target of 33% by 2030. Yes. This government has failed to issue regular renewable energy RFPs, requests for proposals. Indeed, they've only issued one in the last 8 years. That is an indictment on their management of the economy. These RFPs generate fee income for the government, and the capital required to implement these wind, solar, hydro, and waste-to-energy projects is privately funded. We intend to issue utility-scale RFPs every 2 to 3 years to reach the renewable energy target.